Thanks. So good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting in 2023 in session six of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for this morning's meeting. Our first agenda item is to agree to take items four, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. We all agreed? Okay, that is agreed. Thank you. Second item on our agenda is to hear from stakeholders to inform a committee inquiry on race inequality in Scotland. And I welcome to the meeting Farah Farzana, Race Equality Mainstreaming Officer at CMVO Scotland, Danny Boyle, Senior Parliamentary and Policy Officer at BMIS, and Jatin Haria, Executive Director of CREAR. You're all very welcome. I refer members to paper one and invite each of our witnesses to make some opening remarks, starting with Farah Farzana, please.
Do I need to push the button?
No, it's fine.
Okay. Right, okay. So, good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for the invitation to come to the committee to give evidence. So, CMVO, or we like to just call it CMVO Scotland, is a national intermediary organisation, and we're a long-standing consult to the Scottish Government equality sector. The aim of CMVO Scotland is to build the capacity of the ethnic minority voluntary sector and its communities. We've established a network of ethnic minority public and third sector organisations throughout Scotland to which we deliver a range of capacity building programmes. So some of the work that we do within CMVO includes being a member of stakeholder network groups such as the Hate Crime Strategic Partnership Group and the Anti-Racism in Education programme, alongside the designing of the National Care Service and on SNAP as well. We've got a range of programmes within the organisation, predominantly the one that I'm working on is Race for Human Rights, where we look to embed race equality through our human rights lens. So just some general key messages for over the last couple of years, when we got the invitation obviously to come to the committee, is that there has been a general change in tone from Scottish Government. There is a bit more of an acknowledgement of anti-racism, and it is coming through in certain parts of messaging, and this has led to a degree of awareness about race equality in Scotland and the fact that institutionalised racism is starting to be talked about. However, we would like to recommend that, you know, there should be more leadership across directorates and a strong line to focus on visible priority groups. And especially one thing that we see that needs to be improved upon is accountability and implementation, especially in this financial crisis. You know, obviously the purpose of this inquiry is to, of the purpose of us giving evidence today is to see if there should be an inquiry. So the question is, given the cost of living crisis and the financial issues that we are facing as a nation, is it really worthwhile going for another inquiry when we already know what the issues are? And again, just to be specific as well, what is the remit of the inquiry that would be to take place, or what are the thoughts of the committee? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Danny Boyle, please.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, colleagues. my name's Danny Boyle. I'm the Senior Parliamentary and Policy Officer for BMIS Scotland. Just before I give a small bit of background on BMIS and some of the questions or the structure of the discussion this morning set by the committee, just to express our solidarity with Scotland's Turkish and Syrian communities this morning, who are obviously deeply concerned about issues which are affecting them at home, and that's very personal for some of our staff members at BMIS as well, so just like to extend our solidarity with them at this very very difficult time. Also, just for the committee's information, I'm returning this my second day back at work after a two-month absence due to a health issue, so it's delightful to be back, but apologies if some of the reports which I've noticed have actually been published within that period, if I'm not in a position to give as a detailed response to some of that as possible. BMIS, similar to our colleagues at CMVO, we're a national race equality intermediary organisation. We're an equality and human rights focused organisation, and we're democratically led by our members, so that means our board is representative of communities protected under Article 1 of the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. So they come from Scotland's multi-generational Jewish community, Pakistani community, Indian community, African, Roma, and many others. So we've got a really good representation of Scotland's communities who this sort of inquiry, potential inquiry and work should be focused on and be able to engage directly with. In that sense, our membership and our networks are also reflective of those communities in Scotland. Some of them, as I said, are multi-generational and fall within the scope of those Article 1 provisions and the definition of race, which falls within the Equality Act, covering colour, nationality, ethnic or national origin. So they're multi-generational, as I say. It could be Jewish, Polish, Irish, multiple African groups, Pakistani, Indian, newer, what are termed migrant communities from Eastern Europe, A2, A8 migrants, Roma community, Polish again, and a significant number of people who have moved to Scotland from our African communities over the last 20 years. The largest or the significant, most significantly growing ethnic minority community in Scotland from 2001 to 2011, and we would assess again as we get the outcomes from the 2021/2 census. Which is coming now and is going to be incredibly important to inform any inquiry, that the size of that community will continue to grow. Just one final point, there's the sort of structure, the way you've structured it, we would assess it as a beneficial time for parliamentary oversight of some of the issues which are occurring. We obviously had the completely unbelievable experience of the pandemic and the impacts that highlighted for ethnic minority communities in Scotland from these diverse groups. And we've then moved into a cost of living crisis. And we've also, in terms of policy development, been in a period that coincided with a period of transition, obviously changing over parliaments. And that reflected also the changeover in the Race Equality Action Plans, which are distilled from the Race Equality Framework, which is a framework set from 2016 to 2030. And each parliamentary cycle has a distillation of what that looks like in this particular moment. So the next Race Equality Action Plan is going to need to be cognisant of the pandemic, cost of living crisis, Scotland leaving the European Union, multiple things, Black Lives Matter, of course, as well, which highlighted the global issue of colour-based institutional discrimination. And also all of these other myriad of issues which affect different ethnic minority communities in different ways across different policy areas. So we're delighted to be here. We'll provide as much information to committee as we can from our experience over the last number of years and also try and help provide a pathway forward to ensure that the Equality and Human Rights Committee is able to engage directly with the citizens and community organisations you need to hear from.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Danny. And Jatin Haria, please.
Yeah, thanks. And thanks for the invitation. I'm Jatin Haria. I'm the director at the Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights, CRER. We're a Scotland-wide strategic anti-racism social policy charity. We're largely funded or partly funded by the Scottish Government and Glasgow City Council. And we work quite heavily with these two organisations and the wider public sector in Scotland, always trying to take an evidence-based and strategic approach to tackling the deep-rooted causes or deep-rooted issues of racism and racial inequality that exist in Scotland. We've been talking, we had 2 minutes for the opening statement, so I'll try and stick to that. I think the having sight of the proposed lines of questioning was really useful. I hope that's adopted much more frequently. This is not a test for all the three people here. So just one thing I will close on saying, I mean, I think as Farah was saying, there's a lot of activity on the race equality front in Scotland, I think arising from COVID and the Black Lives Matter movement. A lot of activity. I'm not sure there's enough action, and there's certainly not enough action. There's not enough change in people's lives, which is really what the end product has to be. And we'll come on to that I'm sure. So don't be fooled by all the activity that's happening. It's good it's happening, but it's not quite hitting the right spots. So.
Okay, thanks very much, Jatin. I think you're probably touching on a number of the areas we're about to just kick off with. So we're going to move to questions. And as you say, this isn't about getting on, it's about trying to help the committee shape its work going forward. And I think one of the things that we're very keen to be mindful of is that we're not starting this afresh. And there's been a lot of work already carried out. The last committee in particular took forward an inquiry into race equality, and they particularly focused within that on employment and skills, which they felt was really, really important to tackling some of the wider issues. So it'd be good to hear from the panel. There's three of you, so we'll just go to all three, I think, for most of the questions. To hear whether you think that from that that inquiry that the Scottish Government's anti-racist employment strategy, what your views are of that, has it had the impact in terms of the actions and the outcomes, making a difference to people's lives that we would hope for, and that I know that the last committee and the Scottish Government would hope for, but also just to hear your views on what we should focus on. As I say, that we're not starting from scratch, so we're keen. We know there's a problem, as Farah said. So we're not trying to say is there a race issue in Scotland. We know there is. Just like the last committee focused on employment and skills, is there an area you think that we should focus on? So I wonder, Farah, do you want to kick off with kind of two areas? Is that okay?
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. So I think when on the back of the previous committee's report and its conclusion and recommendations that were made, the recommendations were quite good in the sense there was a sense of being able to see what needs to happen to go forward. Now, if we were to compare that to actually what's been happening on the ground and realistic and practical terms, like I mentioned earlier, you know, we welcome the change in terminology and language across, across Scottish Government, but in certain directorates of Scottish Government. And I think what really needs to happen in that sense is it to be across all directorates of Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament, because that's one of the first things that, you know, as an ethnic minority born and brought up in Scotland, it's one of the things that we're quite keen to hear out for, to see where the terminology and language is being used. Because obviously using the correct terminology and language, especially when discussing about racism, shows commitment and it shows understanding. And unfortunately, that can't be replicated across all directorates. So that's definitely something that I've noticed. Again, but though after Black Lives Matter, there has definitely been a shift. One of the things, so I'm one of the Race Equality Mainstreaming Officers for Assembly Scotland. I should have said that at the beginning. And it's really interesting to see the shift in attitudes towards people after Black Lives Matter. And I think a bit of a concern is that it's only something horrific had to happen for things to progress. So that really evidences, you know, that we have a wider societal issue. As grim as that sounds, again, it's one teeny baby step towards the right direction of anti-racism. The strategy that was published in December, the anti-racist employment strategy, it was one that SEMVO also participated in helping to draft. So we're quite, you know, really happy to be a part of that. And I think it is definitely in the right direction, the way that we want to see, the way that it's been laid out, the way that things have been explained, etc. And we've been working quite closely with Catherine Ross and Mandy Watts from the Fair and Inclusive Workplaces Unit, you know, to make that happen. And for example, one of the things that we did was a data improvement workshop last year. However, the biggest thing I think to take away to see is what we've noticed within SEMVO, and I think this isn't new either, and it was touched upon in the last committee report as well, was the lack of leadership from chief executives of public sector and third sector organisations. And, you know, although there was the summit event, I think it was in 2021, earlier in 2021, and again, we had this data improvement workshop, for example, and it was about aimed at empowering, you know, leadership, senior leadership. When it comes to the reality and practicality aspects of it, they're not there. And that's a huge concern, the fact that is not coming down from a top-down approach. They're not making themselves visible, because we know for frontline staff, for example, that is really, really important. And especially, you know, if we look at the term street-level bureaucrats, those ones that have got the decisions of making, who've got those policy-making decisions at a ground level, how much are they being influenced by leadership? How much are they being directed by leadership towards this anti-racist approach? And that seems to be a consistent pushback that we've been getting through, for example, training sessions, or you'll have, like, you know, one or two perhaps who are within HR who are wanting to take this approach, but then the consensus isn't there. So therefore, you know, we're not hoping to make that progress as much as we'd like. So that's what I've got in terms of employment and skills part of it. I'll let somebody else answer next.
Jatin, do you want to go next?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, obviously, the strategy has only just been launched just before Christmas, so it's a bit early to really talk about how effective it might be. Yeah. It has a lot of future commitments, which I suppose you'd expect in a strategy, but the test will be whether any of those are achieved. Having said that, I suppose our problem with the strategy, in as much as it says a lot of good things about what good employers should do, and things we already know, training, diverse interview panels, blah, blah, blah. We've known all this for years and years. There's a lack of measurement in the strategy. There's a lack of, when do we expect things to be achieved by? And some of the measures, like an increased number of employers having better data. I mean, it would have been better if they put some numbers to that, if they'd known how many currently have data collection and how many they want in 2 years' time, in 5 years' time. And then leadership is another key part of it. But what does that mean? I mean, they talk about having senior leaders' networks. I'm not sure what that's going to achieve and who's going to turn up, because senior leaders are busy people. So we need to find a way around this. But I suppose the real frustration is, given all that we know and all that has been said and done, especially in the last 2 years, a much more radical change is needed. We're going to get the census data. It's going to show a higher number of BME people in the country. The diversity in teaching target is still, 4 or 5% only, whereas Glasgow City Council, the BME pupil population is over 20% already. It's just a frustration about whether we're being radical enough and whether we're looking at things in a fast and in a more urgent way that is needed, rather than just saying, we know. If you'll just be good employers and just do what is right, get more training, have a few more diverse interview panels, and there's no assessment of employer racism, I don't think. and then linked to that, there's no. What is needed is an effective means of people complaining if they do feel they've been discriminated in an interview or in an employment situation. We get very few tribunal cases on race employment in Scotland. We know how difficult it is to raise a tribunal case. There has to be other means of complaining, I suppose, and trying to achieve something. Well, I'll stop there.
OK, thanks. And Danny?
Thanks very much. I just maybe make a couple of general points. This particular report and the Parliamentary Committee inquiry which preceded it, obviously the Parliamentary Committee inquiry which preceded it, took place during the height of the pandemic, and I remember it being one of those things, on my list to sort of consult people on and respond to, and it just got swamped by everything we were doing at that particular time. And then the report from the short-term working group has obviously been published on the 9th of December, which coincided with my own time off. I would just make a very generic point. I had a chance to read sort of the executive summary and some of the footnotes on the train on the way through this morning, and the committee this morning has sort of addressed or started to put on the table how do we start to discuss what we're talking about when we're talking about race, equality and human rights, because there's certainly an emerging differentiation in that use of language and what that means to different people. And that was actually touched upon by the special rapporteur, UN Special Rapporteur, Ms Tendai Akumi, when she gave her state report to the UK in 2019. And colleagues from CRED had very helpfully and kindly set up a consultation event for ethnic minority communities in Scotland in a hotel in Edinburgh to discuss it. And we were talking about some of the issues around about terminology then. And what she had put in her final report, and this is just a quote, racial and ethnic terminology varies even among state institutions, and different terms are sometimes used interchangeably in potentially confusing ways. And that continues to be our experience when it comes to assessing, benchmarking and recognising progress or lack of with regards to race equality in Scotland. So as I said in our beginning opening statement, BMIS are an equalities and human rights organisation. That means we recognise communities on the basis of the Article 1 definition in the International Treaty on the Prohibition of Racial Discrimination, which covers colour, nationality, ethnic or national origin. And what we want to see Scottish Government do via their race equality strategy or their anti-racist strategy and increasing ethnic minority employment in Scotland or whatever strategy it's doing is to embed that Article 1 definition from the outset so that the data which is collected with regards to analysing differentiations between different ethnic groups is there as part of the evidence base and there as part of our strategy as we move through the process of analysing where there may be gaps in employment representation. And it was just within reading the document this morning, which covers the Fairer Scotland for All, so the Fairer Scotland for All duty, linked to Section 10 of the Equalities Act in terms of assessing social and economic disadvantage and the intersection here with race. And the part in it, it begins, knowing your workforce data, it says Scotland's minority ethnic population is a relatively small group. In 2021, minority ethnic groups accounted for around 5% of Scotland's population. So that figure is inaccurate. By the 2011 census, Scotland's ethnic minority population is 8.4%. And as Jatin's said, and we agree with, that has increased considerably over the intervening period between 2011 and 2021. So while there'll be lots of useful information in this report, and there's obviously a lot of good work went into it, from our perspective, it's not a universal human rights-based approach to assessing workforce inequality in Scotland, because if you were to do that, you'd have to start from the outset by analysing across those protected provisions and disaggregating data rather than aggregating data up into racial classifications. And just one final point generally on employment, which may be beneficial for the committee moving forward. Census data tells us a retrospective problem, so the problem's already occurred and been embedded. And we can see that across a number of sectors, which are again identified in this report. My colleagues have alluded to, these are ongoing systemic issues. The report, from what I could see, although I may be incorrect, primarily focuses on public sector, which is absolutely right to do so, and using terminology around about structural discrimination in order for those institutions to self-review and make progress, and that's incredibly important. But in terms of a comprehensive race equality strategy for increasing employment, embedded in anti-racism and embedded in the positive duties of human rights, the Scottish Government has to go significantly further than that. The reality is we're in a public sector recruitment freeze. We will be for some time, and actually redundancies are most likely to be coming down the line. So whether it's correct to focus on public sector to ensure progress is made, if you actually want to make substantive progress in race equality from an equalities and human rights perspective, you have to have a much more positive and strategic vision on where are our employment opportunities occurring, where is our capital spending, where are our major national infrastructure projects, and are these procurement processes, which have been significantly opened up since the UK left the European Union, and obviously Scotland's included in that, allows us to be much more race equality specific and strategic in ensuring that those contracts have embedded within them race equality opportunities to ensure that young people coming up have direct access to apprenticeships or whatever it may be. So an example of we're all agreeing on the fact that we've been calling for some of these issues for a significant period of time. The SNP government's previous parliamentary manifesto commitment was to build 50,000 new houses over the duration of the parliament, and we argued in 2011 that there should have been within the procurement process race equality targets embedded within all procurement aspects of that to ensure that young people and particularly the intersection between class and race equality were having access to opportunities for jobs around about building significant infrastructure and projects in Scotland, because that's where the job opportunities were. So there has to be a multi-layered approach to assessing employment and race equality and anti-racism in Scotland, which takes account of the entire economy.
Jatin wants to come in, and then Pam Gosol briefly for a supplement.
Yeah, thanks. I'm not going to get into a discussion on terminology because I don't think it's going to be really productive, but Danny and I have this disagreement all the time. I think if we accept that we're taking an anti-racist approach to what we're trying to do, the terminology will follow. But one thing I wanted to pick up on, which I forgot earlier, was some of the original question was about the previous inquiry and the recommendations from it. And I know it was a predecessor committee. I know most of you weren't on it, but I think that's part of the problem, that people move around and they forget the commitments that have been made on these issues. So there's quite a few commitments where the committee itself said it would write to public sector organisations. In fact, the first commitment was to write to each public authority and ask for a minimum of 3 new actions to address the organisation's specific issues, along with timescales and reasons for those timescales. I'm not aware if that was ever done or what the response to that was. There are things that need following up from the committee itself. You know, it's very easy to blame public sector bodies individually.
We'll definitely pick that up and check whether those actions were taken. And
if I do remember rightly, I think the letter may have gone out, but whether it was followed up and things.
That's a helpful prompt, I think. Pam.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. And thank you for your opening statements and your information on this question. The minority ethnic employment gap is growing, and it's particularly high for minority ethnic women. What do you think the problem is here? And do you think that the Scottish Government's anti-racist employment strategy goes far enough to tackle this issue? Farah, do you want to start with you?
Absolutely. The fact that, you know, ethnic minority women in particular do face additional barriers. One of the roles that I'm in within SEMVO is for the Scottish Minority Ethnic Women's Network as well. So I'll do all the like admin stuff and whatnot for it. But it's been really interesting to, you know, try and reach out to ethnic minority women. And what we tend to find is that there's the usual barriers that women face when going back into employment. For example, if they've had family, if they've had children, there's still that element of cultural issues where it's not necessarily like the permission needed to work, but, you know, do they have, you know, the support of family to be able to fulfil their roles, for example. There are those issues there as well. A lot of people think there's a skills deficit, but, you know, when you actually get into the nitty-gritty and you speak to these like amazing women, you realise that there's a lot of transferable skills that are there. So the fact that, you know, women are automatically, especially ethnic minority women, who probably like growing up have always been put down most of their life, they're coming into this place where they're immediately seen through a deficit. So they're needing to work that extra bit harder to improve their skills or, you know, to have that work-life balance. And it causes burnout and fatigue because those structures aren't there. There's a need for flexibility a lot as well, because we know, typically speaking, ethnic minority women tend to be the main carers, not just for children, but for other family members, whether that be their parents or grandparents. So it's a matter of looking at what sort of flexibility is available within roles. And I know that's something after COVID that's more talked about now. But, you know, lo and behold, if it had been talked about 10 years ago or implemented 10 years ago, then we probably wouldn't be having such an issue. We're aware already of barriers that women face, but particularly with ethnic minority women, there is that level of racism, stereotyping, gaslighting, particularly not being believed, which leads to anxiety. A lot of women that we speak to, they do have really like unbelievable levels of anxiety when it is talking about coming into the workplace, and that will be due to past racial trauma that they probably don't even realise that is racial trauma. And then because the workplace don't acknowledge the fact that there is such thing as racial trauma that employees bring with them, it just goes like it's hidden, it's not talked about, it's not addressed. So that doesn't really quite help either. And that affects confidence in itself. So again, one of the aspirations of the women's network is to, for example, have a mentoring programme, because that's what women are asking for. is to be able to have that confidence to sit at the table like I'm sitting here today. I'm very blessed and honoured to be at this position today. And if only, you know, there'll be other women as well that will be sitting here speaking and making their voices heard. There is a huge issue in terms of encouraging specifically ethnic minority women to come forward and sit at the table, like I said, because they believe that they won't be believed in a lot of the things that they say or they put forward.
No, thank you for that. Can I just ask a question on what you've just said there? I mean, obviously you and Jatin talked about there's not enough implementation, and just talking about implementation, you've just spoken about one of the actions that could be getting done is mentoring. Is that something that's being done by the government or by even third sector organisations, or is it something that you're asking for, that we need that mentoring for those females to be in jobs and obviously be understood and flexible?
Not as far as I'm aware.
Okay.
If there is, it will be something very small. I know the John Smith Centre did a leadership programme, and that I think that was a cohort of 50 people. And I know Sam E have done a mentoring programme, leadership sort of programme for educators within that field through the work that they're doing on AREP, the Anti-Racism in Education programme. But in terms of the Scottish Government particularly, there's nothing that has jumped out or nothing that has been substantial enough to make an impact.
Okay, no, thank you. Jatin, is there anything, or Danny, you would like to add?
Just to agree, but I think Farah covered everything there succinctly and in detail, and that's exactly the type of expertise you need around the table to discuss this specific issue. And then on that point, we would be happy to help the committee engage directly with female-led organisations from ethnic minority communities who have a significant amount of expertise in this area to have these direct discussions.
Thank you.
I'm actually going to disagree with my two colleagues, and I'll tell you why. Firstly, we need to differentiate issues affecting newer migrant BME women to people who've been brought up in school in Scotland. So we need to separate the issues because there are really two different issues there. If you've been born in Scotland and been through school in Scotland, we know from the facts, from the data, that all BME groups most BME groups have better education qualifications than their white counterparts. So it's not an educational deficit in any way. If what Farah is saying, if some BME women are coming out of school with less confidence than their white female counterparts, that's a problem of the school that we need to deal with. We need to stop that happening at that level, not try and deal with it afterwards. So I think we don't know enough of some of the issues. Farah's touched on some of them. I mean, yeah, appropriate childcare has been flagged up as an issue, and that's probably definitely an issue for some women. But we shouldn't paint all BME women in the same light with any of these things. And then we go back to, if we move away from the deficit model, what are employers doing and why are they not recruiting? And, you know, some of the wider issues, and we don't have good breakdowns of gender in a lot of the employment stats. So it's really hard, you know, when we have application stats for BME people for public sector jobs, it's hardly ever broken down by gender or by sex. I don't want to get into that discussion today. So until we get better data, and but we know BME applications are fairly high compared to comparable to their size and population. The problem is that interview, now back to the same problem, are BME people failing at interview because they're not good enough? Then that's a problem of education and other things, or is there discrimination happening? Even if it's benign discrimination of people not fitting, yeah. You know, you won't fit in, so I'll not give you the job, or things like that. We know from the anonymous surveys, just your name impacts on whether you get the same opportunity. So we need to start talking more about discrimination, I think.
So I know you said, Jatin, that you were probably disagreeing, but there was lots of nodding across, and I think you're just indicating how complex the issue is and make sure that we look at it in multi. Farah, you want to come back in very quickly there, and then I'm going to go on to Maggie. But Farah.
Yeah, it was just to kind of go what you were just saying there, Jatin, is that, yeah, if you're born and brought up here, it's a little bit different than if you're a migrant coming into the country. But the bottom line is the fact that, say, whether it's a schooling issue, but the fact is that if an ethnic minority woman is in the workplace and she has an issue, she takes it to her manager. The fact is either she's not aware of the full processes of what is available, she's not believed, or she's not signposted to get the right support. And that in effect has its like knock-on effect on a person's mental health, on their ability to actually progress in their career. And that's why ethnic minority women, they very rarely get any career progression because they're not given that support system in place. So just to further ado on what you were saying.
Rachel, was your question on employment? Unemployment, yeah.
Yeah, so it's quite interesting. Danny's just popped out of the room, but he said that there was an issue with the pandemic affecting race inequality. And I'm trying to tease out whether you believe that the pandemic has set that back, because we know at the time that we're talking about unemployment, people from ethnic communities were twice as likely to be unemployed, they were twice as likely to be living in poverty, and they were four times likely to be living in overcrowded conditions. Now, the first question is, do you believe that the pandemic has set any progress, if there was progress before the pandemic? And my second question is, do you believe that there should be a cross-sectional approach to all these issues of housing, unemployment, poverty?
Rachel, in due respect, we're on to the questions that Maggie was about to ask. Okay. So I'm going to let Maggie come in first. I did ask if it was on the same topic, and I don't think it was. So Maggie, and then you can answer. I think the both questions will blend in, but Maggie.
Okay. Thanks, Joe. And good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming in today, and thank you for what you've said so far. And I find some of the disagreements, to use your word, Jatin, quite interesting, because actually I think what it does, as Joe says, it teases out the complexity within this, but also some of the structural and systemic problems that we face and that no one government department can solve. You know, education can't solve this all. We're dealing with deeply, deeply ingrained cultural racism in across all different sectors. I think, Jatin, you made the distinction between a lot of the activity that's going on and the need for actual implementation and action. And Farah, you mentioned this as well, cautioning us also against treating minority ethnic communities as homogenous for a whole range of different reasons, not only whether people are born and brought up in Scotland or not. I suppose, so my question is around how we, if given what we know about the employment gaps, the inequality in employment that we've talked about, that Rachel and Pam have questioned on, given that we know about the unequal impacts of the pandemic, of the cost of living crisis, and given also that we know that actually very little changed until something like Black Lives Matter, you know, there was a lot of talk. Farah, you said if we'd implemented some of these policies 10 years ago, then we'd be in a different position. What do you think is the barrier that either Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament is coming across? And what are the things, rather than always relying on you and your organisations to fix the problem, because that's not where we should be, how do we overcome that barrier, that deeply ingrained systemic racism? Farah, do you want to kick off? And Jatin, I'll come to you next.
Short, simple, sweet answer, acknowledging white privilege and white fragility within these systems.
Thank you. Jatin.
And holding people to account, and not just the individual, but the whole organisation.
Okay. What would that look like?
Well, so, as I said earlier, I think we have great commitments on paper.
Okay.
They're not followed through, by and large.
Yeah.
So who is responsible or who is held to account for that? And then we sort of forget it for a couple of years and we go back and make the same commitment. We did a study for Scottish Government on 20 years of anti-racist policymaking, since devolution, because things haven't moved on enough and we're still talking about the same things we were talking about 20 years ago. So who's held to account? I saw from a parliamentary question answer the other day, last week, that some health board chairs now have key performance indicators on race equality. Mm-hmm. That's as much as I know, because it was a very short PQ parliamentary answer. But that would be interesting to follow up. And how is that board chair going to be held to account if they don't achieve, assuming the indicator was the right indicator in the first place, and that's always a problem. But sorry, I'm losing your question. So yeah, I think as has been said, I think Farah said we know what the issues are, and we sort of know what some of the solutions are. It's how do
we
hold people to account and not let them off the hook?
Okay, thanks, Jatin. Danny.
Sorry, I think I sort of missed the thrust of your question going in and out. Apologies.
No, that's okay. I suppose there's something. There's obviously a barrier. There's a gap between the action, the sort of recommendations, what we know is wrong, and actually overcoming that barrier, that hurdle. What is it that we, Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament, us as politicians, what are we doing wrong, and how do we overcome?
Just very specifically in relation to the employment report.
In relation to the systemic ingrained racism in Scottish society.
So I think, you know, essentially there's not a uniformed acceptance that that's a reality, and then there's not a uniformed acceptance that we need to utilise our legislative processes and international human rights law and general recommendations and all of the things in our arsenal to make progress about what they actually mean in practice across those protected provisions.
Okay. I'm struck by what you say about that recognition. I think we've seen recently quite a lot of information around racial profiling in the police, for instance, and how there's work on going to improve this, but that the reports keep coming back that our police service, for instance, makes use of racial profiling. And I'm just wondering, what would that kind of accountability look like? For either the police service specifically or any other public agency?
I'm not aware of any particular examples of good practice with regards to accountability within Police Scotland, but okay. The broader issue, not only about the use of racial profiling within Police Scotland and how that impacts within Scotland's demographics, is you'll find that thread of inconsistency and inequality not just running straight within an institution like Police Scotland and any issues which may occur within there, but throughout the criminal justice system. So both myself and Farah represent our respective organisations on the Tackling Hate Crime and Prejudice group. And basically what's happened in Scotland for the last, you know, almost every year since devolution, and it's quite inexplicable, is that we were just given a block number of racially aggravated hate crimes. So we were just told there was 5,000 this year and 4,000 that year and 6,000 this year. And there was actually no disaggregated data on the nature of the hate crime and who was targeted and who was facing it. One of the arguments we've been putting forward consistently is that we need an annual disaggregation of racially aggravated hate crime in order to implement, you know, the sort of informed policy responses which are required to deal with these ingrained and institutional issues, because if it's happening in the street, the likelihood is the same attitude exists within workplaces and exists within the structures which have been developed to provide public services. So all of this, you know, Scotland is in its relative infancy in actually taking an appropriate international human rights-based approach to actually tackling some of the consistent and relentless issues which affect communities in Scotland. And while there's an issue with disaggregation, there's also an issue with how we recognise and actually collate those crimes. So again, what we find when we've just went through a full consultation period with communities on developing a hate crime strategy for Scotland, which will again be coming in the coming period and will be relevant potentially to the committee's inquiry, we find that individual community members from different ethnic groups, when they report crimes to Police Scotland, in some circumstances, police officers are not sure what type of crime it is or how to collate it or how to describe it. The issues you're identifying run throughout the criminal justice system, be it racial profiling or the lack of understanding about how we collate and disaggregate data around about race and racism. In Scotland, holding people accountable, there's now a legal duty on Scottish ministers, when we actually progress with the Hate Crime and Public Order Act Scotland, to provide an annual disaggregation of data between the police and the Crown Office and Scottish ministers, as I said. And that came from a direct recommendation of the International Committee on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. Similarly, in the 2016 review of Scotland, because we can look at devolved issues now via the UN rather than just a basic UK generic report, also made the recommendation around about that the Scotland's curriculum for excellence has to give a balanced account of grave human rights violations, transatlantic slavery, and other issues, which is now developed into the Race Equality in Education report and the very strategic interventions which are being made there. So there are efforts, and you don't see them immediately. They do take time. You know, we have the same frustrations as everybody else that they don't manifest as quickly as possible. But if you want a proper race equality accountability body for Police Scotland or any institution, you would need to, you know, have a discussion and look at examples of best practice in order to do so. And this potential inquiry might provide you the opportunity to set out in that process.
Thanks, Annie. That's helpful. Just one final point. Maybe this comes back, touches on some of the supplementaries Rachel was asking around a cross-sectoral approach. We've talked, obviously, we can say more about what we can ask of public agency or what we can demand of public agencies. But I think there's a key role. And Farah, you talked about your organisations and others who may be doing quite small local support, you know, whether it's mentoring or that kind of thing. I'm wondering whether there is enough support given to that kind of, both within the third sector, from organisations such as yours, but also into other bits of the third sector who will be providing services for ethnic minority communities and individuals. Is there enough information flowing within the third sector and between public and third sector bodies around cultural sensitivities, around sort of broadening our understanding collectively as a society?
So one of the things, again, I should have mentioned this in the introductory session and when I was introducing myself, it's part of the Race for Human Rights programme is that we do consultation with public and third sector organisations. So, for example, at the moment we're sitting with 21 clients, and that is across public and mainstream organisations specifically. Okay. So it allows us to receive a good understanding of where people are, what sort of direction of travel organisations are going when it's about race equality or, you know, implementing anti-racism, etc. So that has been really insightful in terms of, you know, coming here today. I think what the question is about being cross-sectional, absolutely. Just the same way that we would talk about intersectionality, you know, because life is complex. Everybody has complex needs and they cross over. And I think that's definitely something that, again, COVID has brought to the forefront. As well, and just sort of going back what you were mentioning about race inequalities in Scotland, and I had just basically said white privilege and white fragility. Yeah. What the reason why I said that, and I should have expanded on that, is again through the work that we do within SEMVO. So we're national based, so we have clients that are in Highlands and south of Scotland and, you know, everywhere. So it's a really good full picture that we get from different areas. Specifically the barriers they face, and when we talk about these things, there is still denial that there is racism within society or within that local area. There's a lot of racial gaslighting that goes on, and even in meetings that we have, the number of I've lost the number of times that I've been racially gaslighted as well, as well as my colleagues, for example. In any meetings that we go, we still come across attitudes again from frontline members of staff and managers, particularly of All Lives Matter, and you know that is problematic, and the whole fact that yes, we treat everybody equally. These are the type of things that is the reality, and these are people who I mentioned. The term I brought in was street level bureaucrats. Mm-hmm. Those people who actually have the influence in their organisations. This is an attitude that they have. So you know, training can only do so much. So the accountability, exactly what Jatin was saying, where is the accountability? The public sector equality duty has been in place for, like, since, you know, at least 2010. You know, we've had the legislation in there. But what has happened in practical terms? Is there a possibility of, you know, demanding for leaders within, you know, civil service or within, you know, the public sector to actually have targets in place that they must achieve these, you know, outcomes, for example, within this specific period? Because we know this can happen. Like, if we look at gender representation, for example, if we look at the recent movement towards LGBT communities as well. So we know it can happen, and it can happen to other communities, and why can't it happen to implement anti-racism? And that's when I go back to saying white privilege and white fragility is the biggest issue within Scotland, because we don't see it. I'm still being welcomed into this country, and I've been born and brought up here. So that in itself is a disgrace. Yeah. And, you know, when we're talking about organisations, that's organisational culture. And I think that in itself, it is a really hard job to change, because policies can only take on so much. It's down to the human capital within the organisation. That is what essentially fundamentally needs to change. And then that's when we talk about proportional representation as a bare minimum. So then you'll get those people with those experiences, and then that goes back to what Jatin was saying about, you know, the work that they've done, that they've published on the 20 years since devolution, what has been done, and again through it there, it's lack of implementation and accountability. And there has been a number of opportunities that both Parliament and Government have had, and then the question is, we still don't see enough progress, so therefore, how would you expect ethnic minorities then to have trust in their local governments and their national governments in terms of going forward? Why would an ethnic minority want to work for the Scottish Parliament or the Scottish Government or any other public sector organisation if they can't actually see that outward, visible narrative that says that, you know what, we're taking a zero-tolerance approach now to racism, just like we're going to implement 50-50 in gender, and we're taking a zero-tolerance approach towards LGBT communities as well.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thanks. Rachel, did you want to come back in on any of the further points?
Danny, you said that the pandemic had affected a lot of the targets and outcomes, if you like. You didn't use those words. But in 2016, the figures showed that people from ethnic communities were twice as likely to be unemployed, twice as likely to live in poverty, and four times as likely to live in overcrowded conditions. Prior to the pandemic, was there any progress made by the interventions in terms of the race inequality action from the Scottish Government? Did you believe that there was progress before the pandemic?
I think there was progress in terms of acknowledging there was issues, but not enough progress in terms of outcomes.
Okay.
That would be...
And do you now believe that the pandemic has set that, if there was, in terms of the commitment to setting an agenda that was there, but do you believe that that has also been set back, or it's given the pandemic has really focused these issues again?
Okay, so it's going to be, try and make this as useful an answer as possible. The pandemic has exacerbated significantly the pre-existing issues. It was useful insofar as it became such a blatant and obvious issue around about, you know, the social and economic impacts on ethnic minority communities in Scotland, that it became an issue which couldn't be ignored. Simultaneously, obviously, with the increase in recognition of institutional racism and other factors which fed those inequalities via the Black Lives Matter movement has continued to raise that focus. However, the reality is that our society and the way we operate our society, our economy and different levers is not set up to be at present able to substantively respond to those issues which have increased and exacerbated. And I think that's linked. You know, I was thinking of an answer I was going to give to Maggie when she was asking about what's the links between the third sector and our organisations and other organisations on the ground, and links into our 32 local authorities and hundreds of public bodies and what national government is doing. And there's an incredible amount of hard work goes on within our organisations and other organisations working on the ground. Incredible amount of hard work goes on within individual local authorities, particularly staff focused on this work, and within the Scottish Government's Race Equality Unit. But in reality, our numbers as a collective are tiny in comparison to the different levels of policy focus which exist within different areas. And that's also reflected in budget allocation, both to all of our organisations and our compatriot organisations funded through the Equalities and Human Rights Fund, and also communities at a local level, working at local authority level. The reality of, while race and race equality has increased significantly as a conscious issue, and we're having the same conversations again about the same issues, the race equality budget within national government has been stagnant for, over a decade. It's maybe increased by, I think it was £1 or £2 million for the general broader equalities budget, but, it's pretty massive real terms cuts over the period of 2011 to the present day, or the financial crash to the present day. So all of our organisations are operating in quite extreme circumstances, and you're right to look at and acknowledge Claire, Bemis, Senvo, all of the other compatriot organisations, the ones in your constituencies. It's not our responsibility to provide a silver bullet solution to race equality issues in Scotland for local authorities or government or whoever it may be. And I've certainly observed in my time over the years, because of the really extreme budgetary constraints which have affected all of our organisations, and the different perspectives which are taken to race equality, be it a critical race theory approach or an equalities and human rights based approach, is that rather than government and other duty bearers taking a step back and going, right, we have a legal responsibility to all of these issues which have been raised and we need to respond to them all. What I've seen occur is that communities and organisations and individuals are left to compete against each other for their rights to be respected and for those rights to be respected, protected and fulfilled. And I think that's a big basic indicator within that. Is that while we have significant political proclamations about Black Lives Matter and about race equality and Scotland being anti-racist and embedding anti-racism here, there and everywhere, in actual fact, that's not replicated within any budgetary allocations which affect organisations' capacity to develop or duty bearers' capacity to respond to these issues in a much more strategic fashion. The Scottish Government's Race Equality Unit, I think, has 4 members of staff. We talked earlier about race equality and anti-racism having to be embedded across every single directorate. And what I alluded to this morning in terms of the anti-racism in the workforce directorate, saying the national population of Scotland, ethnic minority population is 5%, shows that they're already taking a differentiated path to the minister's stated position that it's an equalities and human rights-based approach in terms of that comprehensive recognition. And within the protected characteristic of colour, you can unpick these issues around about white privilege or white fragility or whatever it may be. But government's legal responsibility and the rights enshrined within citizens in Scotland from ethnic minority communities are broader than that. And so we should be, we should be cognisant of that when we're discussing these issues, to be extremely wary of pitting ethnic minority communities against each other in a competitive environment with extremely finite resources, and actually look to bring them together to advocate on shared experiences, absolutely, and where there's differentiations within colour, nationality, ethnic or national origin, that those are attended to and responded to. And sadly, our experience has been that's not been the case presently.
Thanks,
and that will have been exacerbated, from 2016 to the pandemic to now.
Yeah. Sorry, but we're going to have to watch our time because we're not even halfway through the lines of questions. So can I move to Pam Duncan-Glancy?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much for the evidence that you've given us this morning, and also for the work that you guys have been doing. I think the point that's just been made about the reality for organisations working in this field is really difficult right now. And I know this committee and others have heard how hard it is for the third sector. So I hope that something can be done about that and that government are cognisant of it, particularly within budgets. A couple of my questions have been answered, particularly around the employment gap growing and in particular for women. But I wonder, the Minister said of the Race Equality Employment and Skills Framework that we must have a strong understanding of what this racism is and how understanding can be applied to dismantle the barriers that create race inequality in the workplace. So can I ask just briefly, do we have that? And do we think institutional racism is recognised and named in Scotland's public authorities as part of it?
The answer is no to your first question. What was the second?
Do you think that institutional racism is recognised and named in public authorities?
I mean, from the last inquiry, you'll have seen what some big public sector organisations said when they were asked that question. I think it's Fulton MacGregor who asked that question about, do you recognise institutional racism in your organisation? And that was at the height of the Black Lives Matter movement as well, and so many still said no, this is, you know, not us. That's why a lot of the focus on the strategy and all that has been a greater understanding. But how do we, I think your real question is, how do we enable that? Can we enable that, or is that something senior leaders need to learn themselves somehow? So I think the answer is very definitely no, because if we did, we wouldn't be doing some of the things we're still doing. Slightly going off a tangent, hopefully not. At the height of Black Lives Matter, a number of organisations made statements, you know, condemning racism, recognising institutional racism, that sort of thing. We've actually followed up on the 70 statements that we saw published, and we asked them, well, what have you done since then? Mm. And the answer is, again, back to what I said at the beginning, a lot of activity, they've set up working groups, etc., but hardly any action. And then, as Danny says, has anybody actually put any more resources into this? We can't see any great evidence of that. And also, with some of this working group, you know, a lot of people have now set up BME staff networks or, you know, anti-racist staff networks. We did a survey of some of the work, you know, it's not a scientific survey, it's a very small sample. But some of the BME workers who replied to us really felt they were being exploited, actually. They were feeling pressured, burdened and unsupported in having to participate almost in these networks that some of them didn't want to, but they felt they had to because they're off, you know, of different ethnicity to the majority. So, I mean, I think that is the $2 million question. How do we get people to understand what is racism, what is institutional racism? And there's no easy answer, I don't think, but we should not let them off the hook when they do the wrong thing or pretend they're doing it, which is what a lot of them are doing.
Thank you. Danny or Farah, do you want to add to anything to that?
Yeah, I think, you know, Jan, you're talking about the staff networks and all this sort of... the rapid responses, it very much looks like a replication of what I talked about in my previous answer, insofar as, you know, we'll give a few quid to the ethnic minority organisations and communities and, you know, that's perfect and everything's okay and hopefully they'll come up with a few wins and solutions. It's not a sustainable model. And as you say, people eventually actually it has the counter outcome of making people exhausted and isolated. Mm. The retrospective, you know, HR compliance in terms of institutional organisations and employment in relation to employment law has to be robust. And there is supposed to be a prohibition and discrimination. What I'm trying to reiterate consistently, the committee, be it within internally within organisations or as government or society more broadly, that yes, the recognition of recognising racial discrimination and that being prohibited is incredibly important, but it's not a panacea, it's merely the most basic foundation for what has to come next. And what has to come next is much more proactive policies and proactive policy measures and proactive investment and proactive analysis of, you know, when we're spending money or doing something to make sure that all of the people who need to benefit from it, who we know are disproportionately not benefiting from it, are central to our thinking moving forward. And what we see that as being a critical problem is there is a huge human rights deficit in Scotland in terms of understanding what proactive and positive human rights aspirations are and how that plays out in policy. We are, our understanding of human rights is pretty much connected to the European Convention, which are, you know, negative rights, things we shouldn't ever experience, and that's incredibly important. But moving forward, and certainly around about the incorporation of new international treaties and those rights being legally justiciable, we have to be much more strategically focused on how we use that type of policy development legislation, which parallel to that comes with significant and substantive investment for these issues to be responded to. At the height of the pandemic, we provided the Ethnic Minority National Resilience Network, which was a network of over 100 organisations responding to these issues across Scotland. We, you know, again came up with these recommendations, and what we called for, and this is still on the table, was the creation of a race equality transformational investment scheme. We had seen it before with rural communities and other policy areas, and that wouldn't be for Bemis or SEMVO or CRE or whatever, you know, to make a pitch and take money. It'd be about local authorities and national institutions recognising where their major gaps are and working directly with rights holder community organisations to make progress over the cycle of the Parliament. And when we see that progress made, benchmarking it and moving forward with the next bit. And unless there's that substantive investment, the sort of default position of we'll set up a safe place group, which is around about HR compliance, is not going to cut the mustard.
Thank you.
Just to say, there's nothing new in your question or in the answer, because these things are just have been there for almost mm-hmm. ever. So the in a sense, the answer was the equality impact assessments. If they were done properly, your question would be answered. But hardly any of them are done with any understanding of what an equality impact assessment is. It's not sending me an email saying, can I do this for you, please, which is what happens all too often.
I remember half of your question, Pam, sorry.
Hopefully I remember the other half.
But when you're talking about the understanding mm-hmm. across public and third sector, mm-hmm. I would agree wholeheartedly with what Jatin has said in terms of equality impact assessments. I remember when I first came into this role, and then I had thought, everything's there, why are you not doing it? Because that is the purpose of the equality impact assessment, you know, is to be able to identify these things and then mainstream it all. So, again, I think it just goes back down to white privilege, accountability, lack of implementation, lack of following up. Structures are there, but again, there's just no follow through.
So am I right in saying that really what we should be looking at then, if we're progressing, that to progress the work, we should be looking at what actions have been taken following money, where it's gone, to try and see if there's been a differential impact? Is that...
Yeah.
That okay. Thank you. That's helpful. Okay, thanks.
I'm going to go to Fulton next.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Good to see you all again. Danny, your answer there leads me on quite nicely to my question, because I'm going to ask about your thoughts on the incorporation of the four international human rights treaties that the Scottish Government are going to consult on, and of course that includes the Convention and the elimination of all forms of racial discrimination. I suppose I just really want your broad thoughts on this, and maybe picking up on some of the points that each of you have raised earlier. How do you think, if the bill is to progress, which seems likely, this can benefit racial equality in Scotland? And maybe, you know, we could talk about, do you think it's an opportunity, Danny, from your last answer to see bigger investment in the area? And I'll maybe start with yourself, since you raised it in the last answer.
Yep, thanks, Fulton. I also represent Bemis on the Incorporation Advisory Board, which is an advisory board made up of third sector organisations across different characteristics, who are obviously providing guidance and advice and advocating for the creation of a human rights bill for Scotland, which incorporates these treaties and the ECHR and others. I mean, essentially, the basic point is, if all of the issues we're talking about here move off of a soft law EQIA process and become judiciable, then all of a sudden you have a significantly stronger legal threshold to see the progress you need made. Ideally, litigation is a remedy of last resort, but it's often necessary to set standards and progress things. I talked earlier about a deficit in terms of understanding human rights and understanding the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, the provisions that covers, the general recommendations which we've used previously. We've already used the international human rights law system in terms of racial inequality to get the commitment on the disaggregation of data, to make progress on the curriculum for excellence responding to transatlantic slavery and BLM and other grave human rights violations. So there are already examples where policy has integrated the provisions of that particular act. Where we fall short, as in I've gave points around about the economy, is that making that significant social and economic progress and the intersection between class and race to tackle poverty, to tackle lack of representative employment and employment opportunities, to tackle the fact that the first budget cuts which fall for when national government passes down budgetary constraints and cuts to local government, the first to be axed, almost exclusively from our experience, as ethnic minority groups, and some ethnic minority groups who are providing entirely unique services. And it's unfortunate you won't hear from Trishna from Sikh Sanjog this morning, because a very specific organisation providing an extremely entirely unique service in Scotland, having 100% budget cuts. If the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination was applied within Scotland at that particular time and that budgetary decision is made, then I think you'd absolutely be looking for litigation on that to say it's not been compliant, and that is in fact a form of institutional racism, because the first thrown under the bus is, in this particular example, a group of Sikh women who have no other culturally specific service provision. And, you know, that was an appalling example, and that's occurred in other areas. So when we talk about these institutional things and the application of soft law like the EQIA process, which hasn't worked as well as it possibly could, having more robust litigation opportunities to set standards to make sure that's not replicated in other areas could be incredibly beneficial to Scotland. The challenge is now is round about the technicalities of the bill. We've seen recently with the incorporation of the UNCRC that there has been pushback from the UK government around about where we tread into what are considered reserved powers, or create a higher threshold of rights protection, which is not applied across the UK, which is difficult territory to navigate. But I think certainly within the third sector and race equality organisations and broader characteristics we've engaged with, there is a huge appetite for the creation of a human rights bill for Scotland to enable some of these additional strategic powers to ensure that substantive progress is made for rights holders in Scotland.
Hey, thanks for that, Danny. Jack, in terms of yourself, you know that you and I have spoken loads about bits and pieces of work being done and, you know, becoming, well, let's use it for want of a better term, a bit of a talking shop. Do you have any thoughts on how the incorporation bills could help us to move away from that? Because I think we're all conscious of that, and I think the committee are conscious of that as well. I was conscious of it in cross-party groups. Do you have any thoughts and hope that incorporation of these laws can, can help navigate this particular area?
Not at present, because we haven't seen the actual wording of the bill. If it's more about just incorporating the treaties, we're not as positive as Danny on that, because, A, as Danny said, equality law is reserved almost in its entirety on this issue, and B, British law on racial equality is pretty good, so we're not going to add anything by incorporating the third treaty, we don't think. They've talked about a general equality clause as well in the bill, but we haven't seen the detail of it. That might be of some use. But the key thing is about if you're going to have rights, is how do you enforce your rights? So we need more advocacy. We need more people we need more organisations to go to the challenge when you think you've been discriminated, and that is going to cost a bit of money. So I think we need to wait till we see the actual detail of the wording of the bill before we can be too positive about it.
Thanks, Janet. And Farah, I'm just trying to focus in a wee bit differently, because obviously incorporation of the bills is a massive issue, and I'm aware the convener's already mentioned time. So I was wondering for yourself, Farah, do you think in terms of the incorporation bills, how important do you think it is that BME women's voices are heard as we take forward that bill and try and make some changes there, which, as you've articulated earlier, is in real need of change?
So the incorporation of the four international human rights treaties into Scots law is quite welcomed, because the treaties themselves, they've been designed for domestic law to be incorporated into, and it supports the need for accountability as well, which is what we said. And this is a good opportunity as well to have that maximum impact to improve the lives of those who are most marginalised people in Scotland. But it's obviously got to be done in the best possible manner. So how they become implemented and how they become incorporated is equally important. I know there's a lot of consultation going on around that, but what we really need is meaningful participation. So going into communities directly and doing that capacity building so they can have that educated, meaningful response. And that includes, obviously, ethnic minority women as well. Because when you hear the words human rights, then people go, because it's unknown territory. So I think there is a lot of education that is needed around it, what it means, rather than just saying, OK, these are what it is, and implementing it. It's been a steep learning curve for myself within the organisation. I don't focus on human rights myself particularly. I usually focus on race equality. So majority of my learning has been done by my colleague, Claire Gallagher, who is our human rights mainstream officer. So she does quite a lot of the human rights aspect of things. But one of the things, for example, she has raised is, the experts by experience panel, for example. How is that panel actually representative of the people it's supposed to serve? And taking that human rights-based approach to implement these treaties is really important as well, to make sure that you've got the voices of everybody, as well as of ethnic minority women. So it is a matter of making sure that the representation is there at the design stage.
Okay, thanks very much. And Karen Adam, please.
Thank you. Thank you for so much education that I've had so far this morning. And what's clearly coming across is that there is a lot of activity, a huge amount of work that is going on, but perhaps there seems to be some kind of filtration, that there's maybe not the opportunities there to be able to have that work actually exercised and actioned. And it's perhaps maybe a system that's not, that's maybe in working contrary to the work and the expertise that you're telling us about, And I think one of the important things that I'm realising now is that there's a certain lack of visibility, for sure, and perhaps that's with the frustration of opportunities. My question really is based around, do you think there has been enough work done at the Scottish Parliament in regards to race in the last 20 years? And really focusing in on not just the work that's been done, but do you really feel that the opportunities have been there? And if not, what's really frustrated that? Can I start with Farah, please?
I think Scottish Parliament has always got the opportunity, whenever we're talking about equalities, is to take an intersectional approach. The question is, if the Parliament does that, is that's down to yourselves to look into, in terms of, using that. There is a lot more that could have been done in the past as well, that is within the remit of the Scottish Parliament. that we can, you know, learn from. You know, the role within the Parliament, again, is to hold accountability. So, again, going back to one of the main themes that we've had during this session is about accountability. So there's definitely that. You know, even like chamber debates, for example, as parliamentarians, as representatives of your constituencies, how often or how many MSPs, for example, actually go and engage with directly with their ethnic minority communities, for example, because there is that historic mistrust. A lot of actions can be misconstrued or are then, you know, tokenistic. The intention may be there, but to you know, embed race equality or, you know, talk about things, but then you've got to understand that tokenism is there, and then that is, again, really quite off-putting. Why is this approach being taken? We live in the day and the age of the internet. It's not too hard to do a research. It's not hard to get data and information now. So it is within the remit of staff members, again, parliamentarians, you know, your office staff as well. When dealing with constituents, for example, you know, it's your office staff that is going to be dealing with people day in and day out, more so than yourselves. You are there to represent them. So, you know, what attitudes is it that they hold and that they give, and what stereotype and bias do they give out? For example, you know, these are things that are very tangible aspects that you can do within the Parliament. I know that there is a network within the Scottish Parliament as well. I can't remember what it is, but it is one of the BME networks. And again, to what degree is that going to be tokenistic as well? So I think there is a lot of need to understand when we talk about white allyship and fragility and privilege, is to kind of really acknowledge that, verbally acknowledge that, because if you start verbally acknowledging these things, recognising them and calling them out, you know, if there is racial gaslighting going on, it's very obvious when we see things happening down in the UK Parliament, but how often do we reflect upon ourselves nationally? And if there's a piece of legislation that's gone through, for example, is an intersectional approach taken to it? When we talk about education, for example, does anti-racism come into it? I don't think until now, until Black Lives Matter, it hasn't, whereas we know it's an area that has been researched for the past 20 years at least anyway. And hopefully, you know, with the work of this the committee, again, we'll focus more on the implementation and accountability. As Drayton had said, a lot of actions are there, the activities are there, and I think it's about this Parliament and this committee using its remit and its powers to hold people to account specifically, and not being scared of being specific, basically. And you know, empower yourselves to take forward race equality, because it can be done.
Thank you. Jatin?
When I spoke about the chamber debates, we actually did some analysis a few years ago how many chamber debates on race had been held, and there was like a period of like almost 4 years where there was nothing on race in the chamber. That's somewhat changed after the Black Lives Matter and COVID issues. But I'd be particularly interested in knowing what other committees have done in terms of talking about, even just talking about race equality, never mind doing anything substantial. That might be a piece of work we take on soon to do that research. I'm pretty sure what we're going to find. But maybe, because I know we're going to run out of time, so I want to just abuse my position slightly. So here's some of the things that Scottish Government is doing that I don't think Parliament has got around to addressing ever. So we've got the race employment strategy that you've talked about. Got the anti-racism in education programme that Farah mentioned. We've got a cross-justice working group on race. We've got the hate crime strategy that Danny mentioned. We've got public sector equality duty review that the last committee in the report mentioned. It's been a long time reviewing. Another consultation analysis has just been published, but you know, when are we going to get to actually looking at what needs to change? We've got the Sheckle Bio inquiry. We've got the there's a mainstreaming strategy happening. There's the Hate Crime Act that we've mentioned. There's the Empire Slavery and Scotland's Museums work that is going on. That's just a very quick, that's not the full list either. But I don't think Parliament even knows half of this is going on.
Okay. I wonder if I may, just ask a, sorry not to pick on you, Danny, but ask a slightly different question. It's just because, you know, something occurred to me because you brought up about infrastructure projects and, you know, what we do here in Parliament and, the last couple of committee sessions, we've been talking about human rights budgeting and how that actually works. And it just got me thinking, you know, even in terms of our Just Transition Fund, it's £500 million that the Scottish Government is given to the North East region in Moray. And, you know, our transition away in the oil and gas industry, traditionally white, male-dominated industry. And I've been trying to ensure that obviously we've got a gender balance when that money's been dished out in that area. I want to make sure that women are getting that fair share. But of course, the intersectionality of that and of course our protected characteristics, where is that coming into that? What do you think we can do here as parliamentarians to ensure that these kind of projects are equalities driven?
That's a brilliant question, and I think, you know, I'm glad to see that sort of thinking is starting to enter into your thoughts, and I'd encourage all parliamentarians and their constituencies or local authorities to be thinking precisely along those lines. Our current recognition of the problems with regards to employment and race equality are still following down the lines of retrospective justice being served, which is important, okay, and that should continue, and it's largely focused on the public sector, as I said. Our economy has fundamentally changed within that intervening period, and the 2022 census is going to show us that. I spoke previously about the housing, and we've missed an opportunity. What you've talked about, that £500 million, absolutely, 100%. There should be scoping exercises going on within the implementation of any contracts. Attached to that, what's the ethnic diversity of the communities? What's their age group? What's their profile? And how do I use positive action measures to strategically go out and target these groups of young people from ethnic minority communities to ensure that they are availing of the same opportunities as people significantly more embedded into that system because their dad or their cousin or their uncle works in a rig and is able to get them into a job? Because that's, you know, we know that's what traditionally happens. And in terms of the development of housing, it was plumbers, joiners. All of these trades are really well qualified, really well paid trades, which there's always a need for. And we really don't have any understanding whatsoever. I think there's an almost overwhelmingly disproportionate lack of representation of ethnic minority communities within that. Can I just make one extremely quick point about both this committee and the Parliament more broadly in terms of being able to interrogate race equality issues across directorates in the Scottish Government, which are linked to specific committees within this place, and your role as parliamentarians in the Parliament more broadly? What we find with broad parliamentary debates around about race or racism or race equality is that it routinely, even the Black Lives Matter debate, it touches upon some difficult issues, but then it's very much a backslapping exercise. We are Scotland, we're against all forms of racism. And there's, you know, nothing really happens apart from maybe a story in the newspaper the next day about it. So while they're important, symbolically important for people to see, the nitty-gritty of these decisions which have been made, which affect people's lives, are made within local authorities, within Scottish Government, and the oversight of that is within committees such as this and others. And it's really what we get from that is what's reflective of the capacity of MSPs to deal with and interrogate all of the issues which you've heard here from panel members this morning, particularly in line with what the Scottish Government and other duty bearers' legal obligations are. And I've spoke continuously about those obligations being embedded within the definition of race within the Equality Act and Article 1 of the International Convention covering colour, nationality, ethnic or national origin. Within the dynamic of colour, absolutely, it's incredibly important to consider what my colleague Farah's identified as white privilege and white fragility. In terms of Scottish Government's legal obligations and the obligation of duty bearers, that terminology, while important for specific circumstances, is unable to reconcile the experiences of the Irish community or the Polish community or some of the Roma community or other communities who don't fall naturally within a black-white binary assessment. So it's really important to have this full spectrum of understanding of the issues which you're seeking to interrogate, and realise that they're all of equal importance in terms of ensuring accountability and really creating a step change in oversight, that everything's not to be retrospective around about a prohibition of discrimination. It's really important. It's not a panacea. We need to move forward into much more proactive, strategic vision about how we use everything in our assets and at our disposal to make the substantive change required for everybody who needs it.
Thank you.
OK. I've got a small number of people who've previously indicated they still want to ask questions. If the panel are OK, I'm going to just keep a little bit more time, but if we can make really sharp, concise questions and, if possible, sharp, concise answers. It's difficult because I know we could actually spend the whole day here on these questions. Rachel, are you looking to come in just now?
No, because the original question I had was about, was really for Farah, about running for office here. And I think
it's been covered. That's good. I think that might be the case because we've crossed over on a number of points. But I'm just going to check to make sure that folk are comfortable that their points have been answered. Pam, have you
got a question? Yeah. Thank you, Chair. We've obviously today invited a variety of witnesses representing different minority ethnic groups. Would you say that the policy development distinguishes between different minority ethnic groups? I'll give you an example. For example, what works for a Sikh woman is likely to be different to what works for a Gypsy traveller woman. So I'm just curious about that if that distinction has been made enough, and that do you think one-size-fits-all approach is something that when creating policies it should be taken? And also, Danny, I heard you when you talked about the Sikh Sanjog funding disappearing. It was very disappointing because I certainly did get notified of that last week. And I think, you know, talking about Sikh women, it's very different what Sikh women need from a Muslim woman, from a Gypsy traveller woman, from a Chinese woman, from a Jewish woman. They're all different. That is what I see coming from, obviously, a background and representing many women here. But how do you feel about that, Danny? Should policy development actually distinguish between different ethnic minorities?
Yes, 100%. You know, I can only give the example of how Bemis Run is an organisation. So we don't speak on anybody's behalf. How can I possibly speak on behalf of a Sikh woman or a Jewish woman or an Irish woman or an African man? Completely impossible. What we can do is raise awareness of the situations which affect these different groups, and coming from an equalities and human rights perspective. If you want to hear about how a particular policy area, education, health, anything, funding, whatever it may be, how it affects a Sikh woman or anybody else, any other specific ethnic group, then you have to speak to them. You have to speak to them directly. And within this, you know, quite substantial field of race equality and all of these different policy levers which are happening, some are collectively more important to all of these different groups, but some are really, really intrinsically focused into specific ethnic groups and specific circumstances and specific intersectionalities. There has been a significant lack of engagement around about the intersection between class and ethnicity and class and race, particularly given we know the disproportionate number of people who live in poverty in Scotland and work in low-paid and precarious employment from ethnic minority communities. And if you want to understand those experiences, then you really need to speak directly to those communities, and that's our offer to the committee. The final point is the next Scottish Government's Race Equality Action Plan, which is 2023 onwards, should be beginning what's called a panel process, a human rights-based approach at the moment, participation, accountability, non-discrimination, equality, legality. And that means they, across these different policy areas, they need to be now directing and engaging directly with all of these myriad of very specific ethnic groups, because otherwise they get lost, and otherwise their voices aren't heard within policy development, and that's as applicable to the Scottish Government as it is to local authorities or anybody else. Thanks.
Thank you, Tony.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Duncan Glancy, were you looking to get back in?
Thank you. Actually, my original question's been answered, but I have a very brief follow-up from what's just been said, if that's okay, Convener. Are you aware of the panel process having already started, or is that something that that you've not been involved in?
We're not aware that the panel process has started with regards to the next iteration of the Race Equality Action Plan. We have been offering to play our part in it for about 2 years now, but we've not had any positive response to that. We are hoping it will happen, you know, extremely soon.
Mm. And it's due this year?
It's due this year.
Yeah. Okay.
And Farah's looking to come in on that as well.
Yeah, it was more towards Pam's question there about policy development distinguishes between, you know, different groups of people. Definitely, absolutely. One of the things that I do again with Ensemble is I offer training, and one of the training that we often get asked for is cultural awareness. So the way that we usually talk about these things is, you know, taking an anti-racist approach, and, you know, being able to use the likes of the panel principles to be able to, you know, understand better the needs of the community that you're there to serve, like for service providers. And again, this kind of goes back to my point that I'm making about white privilege and white fragility, is that I think there's an expectation that there should maybe be a script on how to speak to a Muslim woman or how to speak to a Chinese man, etc. And I think that's absolutely ridiculous, because, you know, we get these sort of feedback through training, and that has got to be like one of the main things, not those specific instances of asking for a script, but I think the fact that there's still a need for this cultural awareness training. What do we mean by cultural awareness? Because the reality is that Scotland has got so many different cultures. If you choose one, you'll always leave another one out. So that's why taking the human rights-based approach is ideal, because it encompasses everybody and it takes an individualistic approach, and it kind of goes against a one size fits all in that, and it's not about treating everybody equally, it's like, you know, treating everybody equitably.
Okay, I think that's a really brilliant point to finish. I think that's something that we might think about, how we can focus on that very final point about treating everyone equitably. So thanks so much for all your time, panel. We could have probably gone on all day. I think there's, you've certainly, as well as answering lots of questions and helping educate us, I think to some extent you've raised more questions in our minds as well about how we take this work forward. So thanks very much. We'll suspend briefly to change panels. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Welcome back. So we're now here from our second panel of organisations in a roundtable format this time. So we're going to hear from Parveen Ahmed, the Strategic Development Manager, Saliya, and Pinar Aksu, Human Rights and Advocacy Coordinator, Maryhill Integration Network, Mariam Ahmed, Chief Executive Officer, Amina, Muslim Women's Resource Centre, and Graeme O'Neill, Policy Manager at the Scottish Refugee Council. You're all very welcome. And as I said, this is a roundtable event, so a bit more conversational to hear the issues and concerns to help guide us in the work that we're hoping to take forward in this inquiry. So we'll just go around and ask the folk to introduce themselves. So Parveen.
I'm Parveen Ahmed. I, as you said, a strategic manager at Sahelia. We're a mental wellbeing organisation that's been working since 1992. So this is our 30 years now. We support around 1,300 women a year. The majority are living with or recovering from complex trauma. They have multiple barriers to mainstream services and face multiple challenges within accessing mainstream services and within marginalised communities and their families as well. And they have very little support networks. So the needs are quite very complex for the group we work with.
Brilliant. Thank you, Parveen. Pinar.
Yeah, hi everyone. My name is Pinar Aksu, as you said, Human Rights and Advocacy Coordinator at Maryhill Integration Network. We've been set since 2001 in Maryhill, hence the name, and we primarily work with people seeking asylum and refuge and with the local community. We do this via using community development approaches, a lot of group activities from women's group to men's group to advocacy group to creative methods as well. And we do a lot of outreach work as well, engaging with schools and different events to talk about anti-racism, human rights and migration and how that looks.
Thank you. And Mariam.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mariam Ahmed, and I'm the Chief Executive of AMINA, BME and Muslim Women's Resource Centre. We are a national women's rights organisation supporting Muslim and BME women, primarily through our helpline. And this is a national helpline. And we have the remit around equalities and human rights for women. We work a lot with employability, poverty, financial inclusion, violence against women, and creative wellbeing. A lot of the women that we support experience racial inequality alongside gender inequality, as well as religious inequalities as well, a lot of Islamophobia. So the women that we are supporting experience multiple forms of discrimination, and they are still represented in all areas of public life, such as health, justice, employment, housing. So the work that we do is intersectional. And what I would always say that the work that we do is always very complex because we do have women with multiple barriers that we're supporting.
Thank you. And Graham.
Thanks very much, everyone. And on behalf of Scottish Refugee Council, we're really delighted to be here. My name is Graeme O'Neill. I'm Policy Manager at Scottish Refugee Council. We work with people seeking granted and refused refugee protection in the UK. We also work with people who have been relocated or resettled to the UK. So we work with multiple protection populations. We have teams in community engagement work. We have teams in services, teams in policy, as well as other areas. And we're trying to develop much more our work with people with lived experience in a more organised and coherent manner, drawing upon some of the really good practice that Maryhill Integration Network, amongst others, take forward. We're really keen to talk today about issues, particularly in terms of asylum. We think there's a pretty profound and hideous contortion by successive UK governments of the right to asylum, and in particular the current UK government in terms of essentially breaking the UK away from the UN Refugee Convention, which in our view, in our experience, is one of the most effective anti-racist legal protections, which has saved millions, tens of millions of people's lives over its 70 plus years existence. And we're now threatened with the legislation we hear within the next few weeks at the UK level, which will effectively bury the right to seek asylum within the UK for people who arrive through irregular means, which of course is the vast majority of people, because there is no such thing as a pre-entry asylum visa, which is amongst other things why we feel tragically that people are resorting to, amongst other things, taking small boat crossings, as well as very dangerous other means of access to the territory. So, you know, we think there's a structurally racist problem within the Home Office around this, which is one of the reasons that we're glad to be here today and to talk in these terms. In one sense, we'd rather not be, but asylum has been brought into that structurally racist area in a very naked and visceral way, which is costing literally people's lives. Thank you.
OK, thanks very much. So, as I say, as we go through, if folk members and our visitors just indicate that you're wanting to come in. Maggie, I wonder if you want to pick up from Graham, obviously introduced a significant topic there. Do you want to kick off with that, maybe?
Thanks, Joe. Thank you. Welcome, everybody, and thank you for joining us. I think we heard in this morning's the first panel we have, I suppose that mismatch quite often between fine words and between policies and strategies and actually delivering the action and having the accountable actions on the ground around changing Scotland's approach to racism and challenging the underlying systemic racist society that we live in. Graham, you picked up their very, very specific issues with the UK government and the Home Office and how it is. I think you're in your words, profoundly racist. I was just wondering, from a Scottish perspective, what are the sort of avenues for us as a parliament to be working on to support not only the people you work with, but I suppose I'll bring you in as well, Pinar, if that's okay after this.
Thanks very much, Maggie. We feel that. I suppose firstly to make clear that in terms of social attitudes, we don't discern a huge difference between different parts of the UK in relation to these issues, and social attitude studies consistently show that. So in terms of talking from evidence, we differentiate the public views from, we think, very vocal and powerful minorities at the UK kind of governance level, especially around parts of Westminster, which really take forward a very, in our view, dangerous narrative around asylum. And we feel that in Scotland we have more of a political consensus around issues of welcome to people from different parts of the world, be that through protection routes in relation to trafficked exploitation, asylum, or people that have come for other reasons. But we do also think there's serious issues that need to be recognised around racism within Scotland as well. In terms of what Scotland can do, I mean, Scotland needs to, as a matter of practice, approach all policies that impact upon people in the asylum system, as well as other persons with insecure immigration status, through the lens of what they can do as opposed to what they can't do. And we think that takes you into quite practical places. It can make a real difference to people's lives. You know, Pinar from Mary Hill Integration Network and others have led the work around how to address the social justice issue of access to bus transport and other forms of transport. That's, for us, we agree very much with the campaign that Pinar and others have led on that. That's an example of a uniquely, in our view, straightforward way to protect people and enhance their lives in Scotland within devolved competence. There's many other areas that we outlined in our evidence to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee late last year in a 10-point plan for improving the lives of people with insecure immigration status and people seeking asylum who are in Scotland through devolved competence interventions. So, for example, another thing that we could very practically do in Scotland is institute and complete our own end-to-end anti-trafficking exploitation protection system, which would not only protect some of the most acutely vulnerable people in the country, exploitation survivors, but also protect many people who are seeking refugee protection, because there's a huge overlap, unsurprisingly, between these two populations in Scotland. Some 75% over the last 6 years of trafficked exploitation survivors in Scotland are also in the asylum system. And there's challenges here for Scotland. We could use our regulation powers under Section 9, Subsection 8 of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act and institute a human rights-based identification and decision-making system to wrap around the excellent survivor rights to support and assistance that we have within that same 2015 legislation. That's a political choice that we have urged the Scottish Government to take for a considerable period, and we're accelerating that now this year because we can see a systemic penalisation and criminalisation agenda that is washing over people who come here seeking safety from countries like Afghanistan, Syria, Eritrea, Iran and others. And I mention those countries because these are all high refugee recognition countries, generally between high 70s to 99% refugee recognition rate. The problem is the UK asylum system is chronically slow, it is cruel. It gives people, for example, in Scotland as well as across the UK, if you're in ex-hotels, which is basically experienced as institutional forms of accommodation, then an individual within those environments gets £1.30 per day, £9.10 per week. That's it. You're not allowed to work through UK rules. So you're suffering some of the most severest forms of poverty. That's affecting many children as well. Within, and then it doesn't get much better if you're in what the Home Office call dispersal accommodation, generally accommodation communities. It's around £6 per day that an individual gets within that accommodation. So what we need to do in Scotland is see the extent and the depth and the worsening trends in relation to we think dehumanising treatment of people from all over the world that have came to Scotland seeking refugee protection, see it for what it actually is. The Nationality and Borders Act is cruel enough. We're now going to have further legislation which is basically saying that it's going to bury the right to asylum at all. And where does that take you in terms of the treatment of people from countries that are refugee-producing countries where people are fleeing regimes like the Taliban and others? And what does that say about us as a country if we're prepared to condone and tolerate that type of treatment? So in Scotland, if we're serious about not condoning and tolerating that treatment, we do need to practically, across all our policy levers, including some legislation, some of which I flagged up earlier, take action. It can't just be words. If it's words, then unintentionally we condone the problem.
OK, thanks, Anne.
Pina. Thank you. Just to highlight on some of the campaigns that Graeme had mentioned, we've been campaigning together with the Voices Network on free bus travel, concessionary travel for people seeking asylum in Scotland. And unfortunately, it's been over a year now that we've been trying to have a dialogue with the Scottish Government in terms of how to make this a possibility. And this is something that could be done concretely in Scotland. And I think it was set as such a great example of things that we could be doing differently in Scotland. And there was some evidence at the CPG on migration meeting last year in October that provided evidence how it worked well in Wales by the Welsh Refugee Council. So these are some of the practical steps that could be taken in Scotland. And also in relation to education, when people are seeking asylum, they cannot study full-time college courses, and when they apply to university, they would be treated as an international student, meaning they would be expected to pay the international fee. And from the recent case led by Just Right Scotland, there is a consultation that's taking place by the Scottish Government. And I think this is, again, another area that could be developed and furthered to show that how Scotland could do things differently, because ultimately the immigration system is divisive and discriminative, as Graham have mentioned. I wanted to also touch on some of the things that our members have been sharing with us and some of the recent experience we had. On Sunday, as Graham mentioned, the dispersal process of people seeking asylum is now being placed in hotel accommodations across the country. And there has been a new hotel being used in Erskine. I'm not sure if you have seen what happened, but unfortunately, the local community in Erskine, together with a racist, and I would call it fascist, group who called a protest to say that people in Erskine who placed in the hotels are not welcome here. And unfortunately, on Sunday, I was present there, and I felt the hatred in the people when they were shouting openly racist words and openly racist things towards the people who were placed in the hotels. So my question would be, why is this happening, and what can we do to prevent this? What is the Scottish Government doing to prevent this? Because there is a lot of misinformation being shared in the local communities. And when you place a group of vulnerable people in these areas where there is already ongoing issues, such as, you know, there's austerity, there's poverty that's happening. However, it's easier to blame, as we all know, to when there is an outsider, let's call it, somebody who gets moved into the area. And the hostility that was experienced there and the hatred, I literally felt it. And that was something that made me really uncomfortable in Scotland, where I have been here for 21 years. And I was questioning of how do we welcome people? How do we integrate people when they are met with hostility rather than hospitality? And this is a question I'm asking because we are worried about the safety and well-being of the people who are now placed in Erskine Hotel. And it's not just Erskine Hotel, it's the other hotels across the country in Scotland and across UK as well. And how are we ensuring that people in the local communities know the facts about why people are being placed in hotel accommodations? And as Graham mentioned as well, this is a practice we are hugely concerned, because it is not welcoming people when people are not placed in normal accommodations in our communities. This is creating the notion of us and them, and ultimately it's going to lead to a lot of racism and hatred incidents in our communities.
Thanks for that, Pinar. The pictures on the telly were absolutely horrific, and I think if anybody ever pretends that racism is not a problem in Scotland, then we saw it on our TV screens. It was absolutely horrific. So I think you're absolutely right to raise that as a question for us to think, how can we tackle that to make sure that people do feel as welcome as... I think all politicians want people to feel welcome, but you know, that there was the experience that we saw on the telly. Rachel, sorry, Maggie, sorry.
I was just going to agree with Pinar and say that it goes beyond just the hotel accommodation. There's been accommodation where young women have been put in, where there have then been perpetrators using the fact that there is in a particular type of accommodation that they can access, and horrific kind of gender-based abuse happening. So the accommodation is something which is a big problem, and I wouldn't say it's any better for mothers, but there is a slight kind of better chance if you do have a child. But if you don't have a child, you've got no chance of getting accommodation and accommodated in housing. We've repeatedly had cases where women have been turned away, whether they're refugees or migrants or whatever their status is. But if they're fleeing gender-based abuse or coming in as refugees, the accommodation situation is really, really bad. So we're experiencing that within our client group as well, and it's regular. It's happening a lot.
Marion.
I just wanted to kind of mention about the impacts that you have when you have these kind of racist policies from the Home Office. What I would say is the issue is always going to be for Scotland that immigration is not a devolved matter. And what I would say is that, you know, Scotland does want to show a bit more compassion to refugees. However, we're a bit kind of restricted when it comes to supporting, and especially when we're looking at gender-based violence. COSLA had brought out guidance with Scottish Government about how to support women experiencing gender-based violence and no recourse to public funds. And they really did put the onus on local authorities. However, local authorities then need to find the money from somewhere to actually house women. Now, we know Glasgow City Council have got a temporary 2 week, we'll put you in a hotel or we'll pay for your accommodation. But 2 weeks, and when women are about to leave, you're more likely to be harmed or murdered, you know, when you're thinking of leaving or when you have left. So what we find is that there is a two-tiered approach, with even for women who are experiencing gender-based violence, not only are you dealing with the racial discrimination of these racist policies, we're finding time and time again, and it's very unfortunate, because I would say that my first no recourse to public funds case was 15 years ago, and I really thought that'd create change. In 15 years, here we are. In fact, things have got worse rather than better. But again, that's how you have those multiple barriers there. Not only have you got the bus travel, you've got issues with the hotel. I mean, I've had my fair share of seeing every single hotel within Glasgow, and some of the accommodation that, you know, we've got mums experiencing domestic abuse are staying with children. It's just absolutely unacceptable. But when you've got the most marginalised communities, they don't know how to speak up for their rights. You know, you've got that kind of one path approach. You're just worried about your safety and your status. So then it kind of falls on organisations like ourselves. But when we're dealing with complex cases, and this is where the issue then comes in, these kind of experiences are just not logged anywhere. You know, you've got it from myself, Pervin, Pinar, we can kind of speak about them and yourselves, but kind of we never ever kind of have that chance to actually come together and actually say, what are these experiences for people experiencing, for example, domestic abuse and immigration issues? So the impact's everywhere.
Thanks very much. Rachel, I think we were hoping to
come. It was just a follow-up, actually, to points that Pinon made and Graham made. I just wondered, in terms of Ukrainian refugees that have come to Scotland to settle, I wondered why they found it hard to access social and rented housing, and particularly healthcare as well, and what experience particularly the Scottish Refugee Council had in supporting those individuals.
Thanks, Rachel. I mean, I think the experience of people that have came from Ukraine fleeing the illegal invasion of their country in Scotland, I mean, I think the first part, there's two parts to my answer. The second bit will be a bit more about what we've done. I suppose the first bit's more about that was Scotland, from our views, first real effort within a devolved context to essentially institute its own reception arrangements, its own reception and integration arrangements. So basically, you know, through the Homes for Ukraine scheme, which was a UK government scheme, there's a strand within it often called super sponsorship, which the Scottish and Welsh governments initiated and got the agreement from the UK government to take forward. And that's, in terms of numbers, that's actually been quite an effective scheme, and there's a lot of people that have came proportionately to Scotland. And what I think they've walked into has actually been touched upon just in the last few minutes, which is Scotland, like other parts of the UK, has a profound and pervasive housing emergency. And I mean, we find it really, really frustrating. And I'm not just talking about us at Scottish Refugee Council, I'm talking about the refugee sector. When we look at the issues which are dreadful in asylum accommodation, which is basically you've got huge companies, private interests, making billions of pounds of money from the UK asylum accommodation system to put people who have complex psychological trauma in many cases, are completely new to the environment they're in, and placing them into essentially ex-hotels or military barracks or quasi-detention centres or facilities, the most almost the opposite of a trauma-informed environment is where people have been placed. And it's an industrial scale now. We're talking about across the UK from 2,500 people in such institutional accommodation March 2020. It's now 45,000 people. It's about a 1,400%, I think, increase in that period. And the procurement and increases in dispersal accommodation, the accommodation communities in that same time period, it's about 42,000 up to about 55,000. It's pretty much flatlined. We don't think that's an accident. We think there's commercial reasons as well as political reasons that that's happened. That the amount of money that's been pumped out from the Exchequer through the Home Office to the free asylum accommodation contractors and the hotels that they contract with is around, we think, £3 billion per year at the moment. And that would make what was postulated as a 10-year contract worth about £4 billion in 2019 to 2029, is actually in course at the moment to be a £30 billion contract. And underpinning that, you've got a super slow and very damaging and poverty-ridden asylum system, including particularly in decisions. So when we see all of that kind of like malaise and mess in the asylum system, and then we see what happened with people coming from Ukraine as well, what we found is that there was an industrial use of temporary accommodation for long periods, including in Scotland as well. And what we think that it showed was a kind of underlying fragility in terms of the UK's ability to provide accommodation for people who... That is affordable, accessible accommodation to people who are in that spectrum of socioeconomic and insecure legal status, which includes very much people at the harshest end of the very harsh no recourse to public funds regime, but also includes people who are originally from Scotland and the UK, who are placed, with the homelessness figures out in Scotland last year, who are placed into some of the accommodation that my colleague Marion was talking about, you know, in terms of like temporary accommodation in different parts of Scotland, you know, families, you know, children. So the deeper problem here is for us, the Scottish Refugee Council, not to do with Ukraine, not to do with asylum, it's to do with why are in the UK we not prioritising housing as a top priority? Because for us, it's perverse that the most vulnerable people in terms of poverty and legal status are the ones that are put into the most inappropriate accommodation. Whereas you've got all these other people who are in comfortable accommodation and things are going okay. And then you've got this wider group of people who are in much more precarious circumstances due to the cost of living crisis and cost of living social emergency. And then you've got the people who are at the bottom, for want of a better way of putting it, in terms of poverty and legal status.
Do you need to see a UK-wide housing policy? Is that what you're saying?
I think there needs to be proper resources. I mean, it gets a bit wider now in terms of, like, you know, maybe my remit at Scottish Refugee Council. But I think what we do need to do is we've seen at Scottish Refugee Council working with people at the harshest end of the asylum system and insecure immigration status. People have came from Ukraine, have saw some of that, but not to the same extent as people in the asylum system in places like Glasgow, for example. And because of that, what we need to do, and what this is why I'm sharing this now, is to say there's a wider issue that in terms of housing and the lack. So basically, there's a housing emergency. We agree with Shetwork Scotland, there's a housing emergency in Scotland and across the UK, and it needs to get ratcheted right up the top of the political agenda. And if it gets ratcheted up the agenda, it needs to be the people who are in the most vulnerable circumstances are at the top of the agenda in terms of that housing. That's the way it should be, okay. And we need to make sure it goes towards that, if that answers.
Thanks, Graham. We'll need to watch our time. I've got everybody wanting to come in. So, Fulton, you were next.
Yeah, well, really, I hope I'm not going to be taking up time here, convener. I just wanted to raise a point while we were on this issue. I'm actually sitting with an email that came into my inbox at 10:41 this morning from a minister, and he is writing on behalf of somebody else who's also contacted my office, but I won't mention their name, but they were talking about the immigration status and such like, and I just wanted to highlight one quote in it: that his eviction was dealt with in an inhumane manner.
And I just wanted to, I mean, I think it's incumbent on us as parliamentarians to represent constituents. We all do that. But the fact that we're talking about this issue and I'm sitting with an email at 10:41 this morning on something like this, I think it was worth raising. And that was all I wanted to do.
Okay, good. I think we should move on to another topic. I think that's we've given that a bit of an airing, which is good. Pam, were you going to take us something slightly differently?
It's near enough, but it's slightly different, yeah. Thank you, Chair. Pinar, first of all, obviously, I am going to go back to the fact I seen it on television and I wasn't even there, and it was absolutely terrifying to watch some of the words out of people's mouths. And that's in Scotland, it's happening, right? I was born here, and if that was to happen to me or anybody else that I see around, I think it's absolutely disgusting. So my question is a bit around hate crime. So basically looking at the recent hate crime statistics, they reveal that racism is the most commonly reported as hate crime. And yet there's a lack of data collection on race, particularly in criminal justice. Why do you think that is? And what effect, if any, do you think it is having on the ability to tackle racism related to hate crime?
I think this has been an issue for a long time. And I remember when there was a consultation done a few years ago regarding why there's a law taken reporting any sort of hate crime. I think there's a lack of trust in the system that when people make any form of reporting for hate crime, what happens? Does it get followed up? When I report something, does that mean it's going to be solved? So these are some of the things that we hear from the community. We try to also raise awareness about how to report a hate crime. I think that's another thing that needs to be addressed. A lot of people don't know, unless it's a place of third place reporting centre, or some people report it on behalf of you. Unless people know that, there's a huge, unfortunately, data gap in there. Also, another thing which Green would agree is a lot of the people, when they flee from persecution to seek asylum and refuge, they're fleeing from some form of authority. So to trust authority, I think that's an area that needs to be discussed as well, to say that whether we would get the help from the police if we make any sort of hate crime reporting. I think this is some of the biggest issues, and we did have one incident where we were during the Zoom when in the pandemic, where we literally had a person having a stone thrown to his window while we were having our meeting. And we tried to help this person to make a report to say, you know, this shouldn't be happening. And then nothing had took place, and there was no action to follow this. And that person said, you know, I don't want to follow this up anymore. This is already stressing me. I'm already in the asylum process. The impact on my well-being, on my mental health is huge. And to deal with such a thing without any advocacy and without any support is a huge concern for people. So these are some of the areas that maybe I have to add, but I don't know if anyone else want to add anything.
Yeah, if I can just come in. I think when it comes to the justice system in general, there's always been a very low uptake of BME people using the justice system. If I was to go back to gender-based violence, there's a lot of underreporting within ethnic minority communities. And I think coupled with the hostile Home Office policies, it's amazing about the amount of women that we are supporting that will see things on TV that think it's actually already became policy. And I could go back to an example that we were supporting some women who had experienced a crime and they were refugees, and we were supporting them. We said, look, you know, this is a hate crime. We can help you report it. However, some of them were undocumented. So they felt like if they were to report a hate crime, and I think that's going to be a real issue when we're looking at hate crime from now on, if there are going to be a lot of refugee asylum seekers or people who are undocumented who are going to be experiencing the hate crime, they're going to be experiencing it and they're going to walk away because they don't want to be speaking to authorities. And we also know that there might also be an obligation within police to actually let Home Office know who is undocumented, who is documented. So I think that's definitely going to create a bigger impact on the hate crime figures. Like I said, as much as I tried my best to support these women, they were just like, absolutely not, we're not interested.
To Miriam, that it's not only refugees. I think even people who are born and brought up and raised in this country will often not raise an issue of racism. A recent example was my niece, who, as I say, is born, brought, working adult working in a pharmacy who experienced racism, and her boss was telling her to report it, and she was like, there's just no point. I think for so many years, so many of us, and I mean, talk about myself in that as well, experience racism on an every day, and it's not even a daily basis, it can be an hourly basis. So everywhere and anywhere you go, there is racism there. I think we have very much learned how to block it out and walk past it. And it's become a learned behaviour that you just ignore it and you carry on. And that is the reality. So it's not even about refugees or migrants who are... It's British citizens born here, raised here, who are experiencing this. And it's as I say, we're just blocking it out so much every day. And I think very often it is about people thinking... And like my niece's instance, she was thinking, I thought, I'm so busy at work, I've got so much on, I don't have the time to go and report this, or the energy to go and report this, because if I'm reporting it, I'll have the police here every single day. I think people don't understand the extent of racism, really don't understand the extent of racism. It's in our lives, it's in our faces every day. And I don't see how that changes quickly. I think it's a long, long process, but
it's... go back to that, Praveen, what you've just said. I mean, having racism right every single hour. I mean, I know I've spoken to people, I come from an Asian background, it's there and sometimes people do ignore it. But what can we do? We're parliamentarians here and obviously this is a committee and obviously the Scottish Government will be listening as well, you know. Mm-hmm. What can we do more to stop this and how can we build that trust that you that people, whether they're from refugees or, you know, seeking asylum, or whether they're people that are born here, that the trust is built with the criminal justice system and with the Scottish Government so that people can come to us and speak to us about this? Because certainly it's not acceptable in the 21st century. It shouldn't be.
I think it's about the situation Pinar raised where she felt uncomfortable. But there must have been other people around about that felt uncomfortable. And it's about, it doesn't have to be the black face that reports it. You as mainstream, you know, the mainstream can be, white people can be reporting it. And I think the more we see that happening, and the only reason my niece actually did end up reporting it was her white boss was like, no, you need to report this. You need to report this. And he kept going and he messaged her and phoned her and said, have you done it? Have you done it? And then she did report it. But I think we have been so kind of suppressed in a sense that we do need the white community stands to start standing up and saying, hey, that's not right, you know, and calling colleagues out, because it's happening in professional environments, and it's about calling colleagues out and saying, hang on a minute, and everybody's starting to take a stance against it. And I think that then gives us the confidence to say, yeah, actually you're right, because at the moment I think a lot of people a lot of the time feel they are a problem if they're raising it. So if I've had an incident against me, it's like I'm just going to be another problem for someone. So we need to be raising it as a whole nation rather than asking the black people to raise it.
That's good. Fulton, when we were talking about having this inquiry, one, obviously you're on the Justice Committee as well, and you kind of mentioned that maybe there was some issues around the intersection between racism and the justice. Do you want to just take us down?
Yeah, I suppose it's the other side almost of Pam Gossel's line of questioning there. But one, we were out at the Glasgow Sheriff Court recently with the Justice Committee, and we seen roughly, I think it was 13 hearings that day. It's about the bail and remand bill. But what did strike me and other members of the committee was the disproportionate number of BME individuals, BME males, it was young males who were up. And that did strike me as an issue. And we've often heard about that and the disproportion there. So something is certainly, something appears to be, I'll give them a word, something appears to be wrong there at a societal level that... you know, that disproportionate number. Have to say, just for clarity, convener, that we only seen one session that day of 13 people, whether that's reflective overall or not. We will find out more as we take evidence during committee. So.
Just before I throw this area out, I think in the previous session, Maggie raised the kind of the issue of racial profiling by the police, which then kind of gets a result. And I guess the other area which might be useful to hear folks' thoughts on is what support folk have when they find themselves in that situation in the criminal justice system. Is the support there to help folk through that? Praveen?
Women's perspective, cases that we've had is where a woman was, it's a domestic abuse case, the police have come in, and the male is reporting it because she's lashed out and I don't know if she'd cut him. But the officers didn't understand that she had been so beaten so many times, but she couldn't show her bruises because it was a male officer, and she had to just be quiet and beat up with it. There is still continues to be that lack of understanding. There's that police officer coming in with what is seen as authority and power, and she feels she's not able to say anything. And she's taken in, and she's kept in overnight, and she had a young baby who was being breastfed who had to be separated from her. And she's now, you know, she's been abused, now she's separated from her child. The kind of, she's already having problems with connecting with her child as it was, but there was no consideration given into that, and she wasn't taken aside and spoken to. She was spoken to with the male perpetrator in the room, and she said, "Yeah, I hit him," and so they took her and kept her in overnight. So these things are still happening, and happening quite regularly. And, you know, it's just unacceptable.
I think the issue we find is the issue of corroboration. So if you've got Police Scotland coming out to these kind of incidents and you've got a woman who is experiencing abuse and she's staying with extended family, they've got corroboration, she doesn't, you know. So a lot of the times, I think even if police officers are sympathetic, by law they will still need to arrest those women. But at the same time, I do think that there are a lot of laws out there that do disproportionately impact BME women or just BME people, and I think there's definitely something to look at. You know, if you've got, you know, are there more men that are being arrested? Are there more women, I would say, that are being arrested, for example, arrested when they're the ones that are experiencing domestic abuse? What we also find then is another hand is we have a lot of BME women who are in the childcare system having their children separated from them because they might smack the children or whatever, but not understanding that smacking is actually illegal within Scotland, because when the smacking ban was brought in, there was absolutely zero consultation done with a lot of BME women's groups or refugee women's groups to explain to them about laws. So there's still a lot of laws and legislations that we have within Scotland that would actually disproportionately impact BME women or just BME people in general. And I think there's still, so even with our existing laws, there's a lot more work to be done.
Graham, will you?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that we've noted over each year is that in 20 years of the evolution, there hasn't been an inquiry, an inspection by any of the constabularies in the criminal justice system, you know, the inspectorates in the criminal justice system, of the relationship between the Home Office and the operation of the criminal justice system in Scotland. So, you know, from the Police Scotland now, and through to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, through to the Scottish Prison Service, and through to the courts themselves. So we think that's a gap that needs to be filled. We've raised that a number of times, as has the Justice Subcommittee on Policing that John Finney chaired before. I think the truth is it was ignored in practice, but not in terms of, we did get a response, not ignored by the Justice Subcommittee, but I think it was the Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland. We did get a response, but the response to me wasn't substantive, because the response spoke about, nobody's really raised this with us before. And we're saying, well, this is why we're raising it, because with 20 years of devolution, Scotland's becoming an increasingly diverse population. But even if it wasn't, we'd still be looking at how the operation of the criminal justice system affects communities, especially but not only migrant communities, because what we could see, as Pinna talked about, is that people are quite distrustful of authority, especially people that have come from a refugee background. But also, we can also see, as I touched on earlier on, that the stakes for people seeking refugee protection and have an insecure immigration status in the UK, including in Scotland, have just got so much higher over the last 3 or 4 years, such that now it's a criminal offence to arrive in the territory, be it in a beach or be it in a lorry drop. In the UK, you're immediately liable to a criminal offence of unlawful arrival via the Nationality and Borders Act 2022. So, you know, it's for us incumbent upon the criminal justice institutions in Scotland to say, OK, how can we get a grip of this? Now, we've pushed this through the Scottish National Action Plan Leadership Panel. They've agreed to it, to their credit, which is good, that there should be such a review, but we understand it's now with Scottish Government to consider, and one of the reasons I'm raising it now is that we really hope they make the right decision on that and actually take forward that review about the interaction between the Home Office and the Scottish criminal justice institutions in Scotland, because it's never been done before, and also the stakes are very, very high for people at the kind of the sharpest end of the UK Government's ever more hostile environment.
Good. Praveen?
Just something that I thought I should raise was I feel that there needs to be greater recognition around the benefits of relationship-based practice. Certainly in our work, women are building a relationship with the caseworkers that they're working with. They become confident and begin to open up and disclose all sorts of issues and trauma, etc. But then from there, when we're trying to get them support and services, there is almost an expectation that, you know, we'll hand them over, in a sense, so to speak, that and someone else will take on. So whether it's social work or whether it's police or whether it's NHS, that someone else will come in and begin that support process. But it doesn't work because there isn't the language support. They don't know the history of the woman. And they don't know the complexity of the trauma, etc. But within the third sector, there is so much expertise and specialism, and the workers build that trust and build that relationship to the point where they are then able to engage the women and help her begin to access services and support. That's our kind of relationship-based practice, I think, has to be expanded so that work staff that have already built that relationship can continue to support women through a whole process. That's not happening. It was incorporated in the Christie Report in 2011, but it's never really been pushed in terms of active practice. And I think that really makes such a difference in terms of women feeling able to begin, or anybody who is vulnerable feeling they can actually engage. And I think that really needs to be kind of looked at again and looked at how can we roll that kind of practice out. Obviously, it needs resourcing, and the third sector being the kind of so minimally resourced is a big problem. And we know that resourcing is difficult across the board. An issue that actually was brought to our attention yesterday was Edinburgh Council is cutting funding for third sector organisations, and the biggest cut is going to be around education and youth. That's really concerning for us because usually what happens in those kind of situations is the type of service that will be cut will be like the ESOL classes, which are English for speakers of other languages. These kind of activities make such a big impact for women because if they don't have the language, they can't engage, they can't begin to even access services. The interpretation services that are there, are supposed to be supporting them, are often are very problematic. There's a lot of issues around interpretation services where interpreters are coming in with their own beliefs and their own culture, and they're imposing that on. We've had situations where an interpreter was basically interpreting to a young lady that you should be ashamed of yourself raising this. Look how upset your mother is because you're raising this in a panel session. Nobody else understood, but our worker was bilingual, so she had to stop the panel session and say, we have to stop this, this is what's happening. And nobody at the table knew what was actually going on there. So that kind of thing happens regularly, but if we take away resources like the ESOL classes, which seem to be, you know, we don't need that, but actually we do. So it's really concerning because if Edinburgh City Council is moving towards this kind of work, removal of funding, then other councils will be doing the same as well. We know councils are under a lot of pressure at the moment, but I think they really need to think about what impact taking away funding is makes in terms of the impact on diverse minorities and the intersecting needs of communities that they're taking resources away from, and I think that's something just to be very aware of.
That's really useful, actually. It solves a topic that's come up before. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for that. And just probably going to go back a little bit, if that's OK. I don't think I put my hand up in enough time to ask the question at the right moment there. I'm interested in, and actually we've just heard a bit from Parveen around relationships and the importance of relationship, relational approach. I worry that race relations, which kind of takes me back to when we started discussing things around the Equality Act in 2010, it feels like quite an old statement to make, but I'm worried that race relations and what you're saying could be getting worse. And I noted Pinar's comments on people being placed in hotels rather than ordinary community situations. I've got a couple of questions about it. I've been worried about what that means, particularly in Glasgow, but also for the people who are now currently on MS Ambition. I'm worried about where they're going to go when that closes at the end of March. And have you noticed any impact on race relations in the city and across Scotland as a result of the more hostile environment, but also of the way that we've been putting people into sort of unusual accommodation circumstances, as we might call it?
Thank you for that. So because we work with welcoming people and we work with people directly, and we have a lot of services that we provide, as Parveen mentioned, in terms of ESOL classes and other areas as well, it has a huge impact of making someone feel welcome. Mm. And it has a huge impact of someone to be part of a community. When people are placed in rural areas, especially on hotels, and as earlier Graham mentioned, there's a huge profit being made by the hotels, and we need to highlight that, and I think we cannot hide from that. The hotels that are being used are usually isolated from community and are in areas that's hard to reach. And when somebody is given £9.30 pence a week, how do we expect them to travel to colleges? How do we expect them to travel to communities? How do we expect them to go and see their lawyers? So they are actually disconnected from society and placed in a detention-like condition. And one of the horrifying thing on Sunday in Erskine was I had a brief chat with the mayor's officer on the day, and the way that he spoke was saying we're going to flourish this area in 6-7 months. So for me, that means there is a clear indication that they actually want to keep the people in hotel accommodations longer than week spaces, and they want to keep people in there and create a hostile environment where they are disconnected from society and where they are actually creating programs of activities in the hotels. And there's a huge worry for people's safety. As I mentioned, if there's misinformation being highlighted in the news, if there are groups mentioning that these people are not welcome, who's going to protect the people in the hotel accommodations? What if something happens, is my question. We have seen what happened in Park Inn incident in 2020. A life was lost, and it was the first time that a person was killed in Scotland by Police Scotland in a knife crime incident. And what if something happens? Who's going to be responsible for these actions? And we have been highlighting this since 2020. And unfortunately, as one of the things that Pam also mentioned, is people are going to be disconnected from society. And this is where we're going to see the racist and discriminative immigration system being implemented in Scotland. It's going to be us and them, where we fear the other people who are actually seeking asylum and refuge. And I think in Scotland, we can do something differently, where we condemn. I have not seen anything from the Scottish Government after Sandy's incident, condemning the actions and condemning that Scotland is a welcome, saying that Scotland is a welcoming country and that we condemn any form of racism. I have not seen this any form platform. And I think condemning And challenging these misinformation is something that we can do in Scotland. And preparing the communities, I think, is so important. Placing people in rural areas and areas which is already deprived and has ongoing concerns. And if you place a group of people, obviously the community is going to blame and point the finger there. And we have seen this history repeating itself. I think preparing the communities, if this practice is going to continue, is a huge work that needs to be done, and it could be done where we create maybe community cafes, where we create community conversations, and this could be led by the local councillors and the local authorities where the local community is being informed.
Yeah. Mariam.
Just to come in, Pam, about Glasgow and Glasgow communities, I think one of the issues for me definitely needs to be about funding. And going back to that, if you look at the Glasgow Communities Fund, if you're looking at the Edinburgh Fund, the amount of well-established BME organisations that have been caught in those fundings is a real issue. You know, you're kind of looking at the list with absolute disgust to think those organisations just no longer exist. And those are the organisations that are far fighting hard for racial equality. And I think just kind of going back to that, when you're looking at then on top of that, the COVID-19 pandemic, you know, disproportionately impacting BME women or BME people, but then on top of that, the cost of living crisis, Bangladeshi, Pakistani households experiencing poverty a lot harder, and then these funding cuts. And we're actually sitting here talking about racial equality and how to better that. We're never ever going to get anywhere further. You know, we can have all the best policies in the world, you know, within Scottish Government, but then if we're not actually funding and actually helping those works to actually better racial inequality, and just those kind of examples that I've kind of given are already going to be setting so many BME communities back.
Pervin and Graham are both hoping to come in.
I think Mariam's kind of covered my topic.
Okay, Graham.
Thanks, convener. I wanted just to say a few things. Like, first was to say that one of the reasons we are, from an anti-racist perspective, we are so concerned about what the Home Office are doing with this deeply irresponsible practice of essentially moving people with no consent from local authorities or devolved governments to different parts of the UK, including, of course, here, into this institutional type accommodation, the type of very cruel conditions that it is that it does create a series of really serious consequences. The first is we know as a matter of evidence there's been really significant mental health escalation at scale for people stuck in these environments, the 45,000 and growing across the UK, just under 1,000 in Scotland at the moment. The second is, tragically, we've seen a tragic acceleration in loss of life within these environments as well. You know, Liberty Investigates, ourselves and others have done a lot of work on this. The Ferret and Investigative Journalist platform, because the Home Office don't monitor and certainly don't talk about this, but we've seen a disproportionate number of people lose their lives, including, and I've seen some of the incident reports myself and in a redacted form, including people, you know, dying in despair and also confirmed suicides. So that's the second consequence. The third is that when you treat people in such a marginalising way and a segregating at times de facto way, as has happened with this Home Office practice, then people become much more exploitable. Yeah. You know, so what you're actually doing through another strand of this deep irresponsibility of this Home Office practice is it's making communities feel more unsafe, yeah, because it's making people very, really exploitable, mm-hmm, as well. And remembering these are people that have fled persecution and terrorism and other dreadful environments. They are desperately just wanting safety. That's what they want more than anything else. But the Home Office practice deliberately denies them that. And the fourth is the far right and extremists. Like, you know, Patriotic Alternative have exploited what's happened here and done what they do across the UK. And this comes from this Home Office practice, but as Pinner said, it does definitely need a coherent public national response from Scotland on it, including from the Scottish Government. That's really important as part of the anti-racist approach that anyone should take. And the final thing was just to say that, as Pinner said, look, you know, Helena Kennedy, Barnes Helena Kennedy, KC, you know, conducted an inquiry in behalf of Refugees for Justice. Pinner would speak better about it than I. That was a document that was published last November. I've never been at a more dignified and more powerful launch event in my life in 20 years working in human rights work. And it was because it was led by the people who were actually affected directly by it. And you could see the cohesion there. As far as I'm aware, there's not, still not been a response from the relevant parties to that report. That is a vital learning document to what Pinner and others are describing around what happens when you have this institutionalising, commercialising approach to people who come here seeking safety and placing them into these ex-hotel regimes. You know, we need to use that document, apply its recommendations as much as possible and devolve competence to actually practical learning. Back to Maggie's first question, what can we do? Yeah. Well, then we read that document, respond to that document and implement as much of those recommendations within devolved competence. I understand Refugees for Justice are still seeking the meeting with the First Minister. We really hope that happens because we know the First Minister cares about these issues deeply as well, and we think that would be a really constructive way forward. So in terms of what we can do, that would be the next one, is to actually meet Refugees for Justice with Baroness Helena Kennedy and the First Minister so we can take that work forward together, that learning together about what can be done, because that Home Office practice is getting rolled out systemically, as I described earlier on, across the UK, and it's going to create all these very harmful impacts, and it's also perversely creating opportunities for far-right extremists, and that will create more unsafe conditions for all visible ethnic minorities within a UK context, because if far-right extremists feel they've got the oxygen of publicity and they've got the oxygen of the opportunities to exploit, then they will exploit those opportunities, as we're tragically seeing most recently.
Karen, I'd discourage you from commenting on this topic. We've gone off, we've done a few others, we've come back to it, so do you want to come in now?
Yeah, I was going to come in on mental health, if that's okay, yep. Convener. It's just everything I've heard so far paints an extremely grim picture. We're already in a mental health crisis, and putting that racial lens on top of that it is really concerning. We know, and we've heard from experts, that mental health issues are exacerbated by disconnection, and that's a word that I've heard a few times, and that connection can almost be an antidote to some mental health issues. You know, we're hearing about that disconnect, whether it's in language or a disconnect from place and community, and I'm just wondering if you could paint a picture of what that really looks like when we put that racial lens on that, and if you know, what can we do? What can we do in that regards? And Pervin, I need to ask you.
The women we work with, all of them suffer, come to us suffering from mental health, and the reality for a lot of them behind it is racial inequality and gender-based discrimination. They come in with all sorts of horrendous situations of being sexually exploited. There's women who've been trafficked. There's women who have been born and brought up in this country and are just being abused by partners, communities. Unfortunately, the communities we work with, very often it's not just then the partner. There is extended family and extended communities who will add pressure to them to stay and remain within in abusive relationships, all of which has a huge mental health impact. This then rolls into the health sector, because then they're trying to access health services. Health services are then sending them away with very, very high doses of antidepressants, but the real problems are not being dealt with. They can't leave the perpetrator because sometimes they have no recourse to funds, or the perpetrator is withholding money. We've had situations where a woman was... they were receiving £600 for their children in benefits, but the partner was telling her he was only getting £100. She was really struggling to make ends meet, even feed the children, living in real poverty. So there are situations where there is a family income there, but it's not filtering in down for the woman or her children. So she was basically in dire poverty, and her children were starving, and she'd come to us for support. it was by chance the caseworker, because she didn't have the language either, the caseworker, she had brought along bank statements and things at one stage when they were looking at seeing if she could get benefits, and she realised that actually the partner, there was an amount on it which was clearly a benefit. These are the kind of situations they're coming in with. So, you know, how do you apply for a benefit when the partner is already getting a benefit and she can't access it? She can't leave the partner because she doesn't have recourse to public funds. She can't get housing. She's feeling that moving away is a risk to her life, and that's a genuine risk at that point. If she leaves, there is a genuine risk where she feels she may be killed, her children may be taken away, they may be taken abroad. The fear is huge, unimaginable, and she just can't leave. These are kind of the situations. And then she's accessing health services, but the health services are not understanding what's going on. She's trying to access benefits, but she needs to have the language to make either a phone call or to do it digitally. And this is another problem that's now coming. We're seeing every day everything is becoming digitalised, and not all women have access to IT, or they don't have the language, or they just don't have the skill, or if you put yourself in that situation, you're so traumatised, you just don't have the capacity and the resilience to sit down at a computer and do something like that. It's, even as a professional trying to fill in a form, I'm like, oh God, this form. Imagine what she's like. She doesn't have her own paperwork, so she can't load evidence on. So all these kind of things are kind of adding to it, and it's another systemic form of inequality and to some extent racism, because then as someone who doesn't have the language and capacity to fill those forms or speak on that phone line, you know, what does she do? She can't have a worker speak on her behalf, because if she can't be present when they call back or there's a call coming in, then the benefits agencies will not talk to you unless she's present. So they're getting all these kind of things which add to the exclusion for them as well. And then professionals just not understanding the fact that, are not understanding what's going on, and there's no understanding of her background. So she may have come through a horrific asylum process, or trafficked, or just culturally where she sits, she's not able to just get up and leave, or she feels unable to get up and leave. All of these things have huge impacts on her mental health. But you're right in terms of the connections. If the way we work is we help her make connections initially with the services, but then also within the communities to build up a community of support for herself. And that has a significant impact in terms of helping with her mental well-being. But it's a very long process. It's a very costly process. We have staff who speak at least 14 different languages, but we have something like 58 different women from 58 different origins. The resources that is needed to support her both in terms of providing counselling support, casework support and language support, it's huge. And I think there's not enough recognition given to the fact that to support a white woman costs a lot less than it does to support a woman from a different ethnic background because of the language issues. And the amount of support that needs to be put in language-wise, which is on top of everything else, but also the time that it takes is much longer because the issues are much, much more complex for her. So, if there's an immigration issue, that can take weeks and months of support. And that's not factored into resourcing and funding, and I think. So that's something certainly that can be looked into or needs to be looked into, I think.
Mariam, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I'm just going to say, when you're kind of dealing with those multiple forms of discrimination and barriers, mental health always seems to be like the afterthought. So you're too busy in crisis, too busy firefighting, trying to deal with those kind of issues. And I think there definitely does need to be more investment within mental health and BME communities. One of the issues that we do come across is just very simply that a lot of BME women don't feel like they get that intersectional approach when it comes to trying to find BME counsellors or black and brown counsellors. It's almost sometimes feels impossible. So just very much about if I'm going to be in a counselling session, I'm going to have to explain everything about what is honour-based abuse, so what is racial justice, or what is the fact that I've experienced a bit of Islamophobia, whereas a lot of BME women do feel like if they do have a black and brown counsellor, it's just easier, you know, they don't need to explain, but there's just a lack of investment within that also.
Maggie.
Very, very quick supplementary just on that, and I hear, I acknowledge what you're saying about the lack of, we don't train a diverse range of counsellors, a diverse community of counsellors in Scotland. We just don't do that. But for those of you who provide direct support, I'm interested in, Pervin, you spoke there about, you know, the complex cases needing much more support. From the point of view of your staff and volunteers, do you feel that, or what more needs to be put in place to ensure that we actually minimise vicarious trauma? Because I can imagine that some of the stories, some of the things that your workers have to deal with can be pretty extreme as well.
Absolutely, and we have that a big thing that we have to deal with, a big part of our work. We put in additional work support. We have external counsellors coming to support the staff as well. But that again, it's about resourcing, because those support mechanisms can be put in to support the staff team, but it needs resourcing. And again, it's another bit of resourcing that falls down, because it's like, do we support the women directly, or do we support the staff? And we're constantly having to balance that, and it has to be a balancing act. A majority of our staff are actually ex-service users, so vicarious trauma is a huge, huge risk for us.
Okay. Pina, you wanted to come in?
Just to add on that, for the impact of mental health and well-being for the people seeking asylum, we're talking about a period of time when people could be in the asylum system for a very long time. We have some cases where people have been seeking asylum for more than 10 years. So we're talking about the process of waiting for 10 years. And for us, it's the process that's killing people, and it's the waiting time that's killing people gradually. And we can see that in the way that people represent themselves. And when we meet people initially, when they come to our doors, we see them the day we meet them, and then we see them after a few years, and we gradually see how it's impacting their well-being and mental health, especially because when they're in the asylum process, they don't have the right to work. So that means they have to go and do a lot of volunteering or go and do courses at colleges, which is not going to benefit them, and maybe repeat courses at colleges. And as mentioned, Parveen mentioned, it's the lack of resourcing and where the information is provided for people that we can refer to. So one of the things that we find useful is people coming to our services, whether that's ESOL class or art group or advocacy work, that's a form of supporting people with their well-being and mental health. However, when it comes to professional work, we find that we struggle to refer people to organisations where they will get this help and support they need. One of the things we just started doing, and I'm glad that Eamon is here with me, is we started a peer support volunteer role where we are recruiting volunteers who are in the asylum process or went through that process to provide that support as a peer, in the form of a peer support role, where they can advise each other and go to maybe hearings at the courts as a form of supporting people. However, this is something that we are piloting, and it would be amazing for the Scottish Government to look at the pilot and maybe extend this so that it can be implemented in other areas as well, so that it's a form of supporting people. But for a more professional support on what you mentioned about mental health, is we need more resources for this, and I think it should not be falling into the third sectors. It should be something that needs to be national.
Yeah, it was just to follow on from what's been said. I mean, we run a refugee integration service, have done for about 10 years, and I mean, it's not perfect, but it does a lot of good work. And one of the things it's basically doing is saying, you've came through, as Pinar said, this pretty grim and often very slow asylum process, and you've not been allowed to work while you've been stuck in that process. And if you've been eventually granted refugee status, then from that you're now moving into trying to, that second bit of often the refugee experience, building a new life. You've got away from the bad stuff and now you're trying to build a new life. And I suppose standing back from what that service is trying to do, informed particularly, but I think, Karen, your question around, you know, there's this escalation of mental health risk and also problems and the reality of problems in systems that affect not only, but in this case, people who are affected by the asylum system or wider forms of insecure immigration status. You know, people in those environments, as certainly I've been listening in the last 5 minutes or so, what's coming out to me, and kind of sense checking it every day, is that basically, you know, there's a really dangerous intersection that people with insecure immigration status or gender abuse survivors or coming through refugee persecution or at risk of exploitation. That's a really dangerous intersection people are placed at. And some of the things that contribute to that, in our view, is the Home Office structurally racist system around immigration, and also within that, and as a kind of key agent within that and driver of that, the no recourse to public funds regime and the rules. So given that, going back to, I think, Maggie's initial question around what can we do, then I think we just need to recognise that is the reality, that people who are at that dangerous intersection and sadly are continuing and probably more so put into, and in Scotland, one of the things we can do is fund national integration services. I actually think there's a strong case for some of it to be taken forward with the third sector because of the expertise that's in the third sector and the kind of low accessibility deliberately that the charity sector has. That's part of what it's there to do, is to provide that. But we need to, in terms of the can-do work we can do with devolved competence, really take seriously that dangerous intersection that people suffering bad experiences, which always have or often have that insecure immigration status part to it, there's something different and more detailed and more focused and specialist, basically, that people at that intersection need. Now, we are one strand of it, refugees, but that people are people. They're not just refugees or asylum seekers or trafficked exploitation survivors, etc. People often go across a lot of these groups. But the thing about what can we do in Scotland? Well, we could fund national integration services to take this work forward, you know, and drawing upon the expertise of many of the third sector bodies here. And practically, I'd hope the committee could recommend something along that once it's considered it further. Because otherwise, you know, we're going to be firefighting all the time as the system out there gets worse. And that's not good for the public sector, the local authorities as well, because then what happens, you get into these individual cases where people in third sector bodies, we do it as well, advocate rightly for our clients in relation to, for example, the difficulty of getting into like public sector local authority commission support, because it's quite a high threshold for that. But we'd ideally not want to have to get into those situations if we were better resourced in the first place to try and more effectively support people. So there's something important about national integration services for people across vulnerable predicaments.
Okay, thank you. Praveen?
I was just going to add in to the earlier conversation. There was a news article about a family who was displaced from a hotel and they lived there permanently, and a refugee family was moved in. I think that type of PR is not helpful because it's stuff in the public, because it's basically saying local people are being displaced and it's again creating a them and us kind of attitude. And I wondered what the thinking behind doing that had been at the time. It's clearly about the economy and trying to the people income for certain communities. And it just makes me think that in terms of when policies are being developed, there really needs to be a race focus on them, and it needs to be very, very early. So I'm thinking that a lot of the use of hotels in kind of remote areas is about let's build the economy of those remote areas, but there's not, race has not been part of the assessment of what happens when we do this in terms of racism. So that really needs to be brought to the table at a very early stage, rather than at the end when things start going wrong, or kind of, you know, okay, we've finished doing what we're doing, but oh, let's look at it with the race element. The race needs to be there as part of the assessment process right at the beginning of any policy, whether it's about economy or anything. So it's any policy within government, I think, has to have race at the start involved.
Good. We're kind of really past time. I was just about to say, if anyone's else got any point that they don't think we've covered, let's just make sure we hear it now. But so, Praveen first.
Apologies. I was going to say the Fair Work document, nation document. I had a concern about that because it's got a deadline of 2025. As you know, that's when we're wanting to be a fair work nation, leading as a fair work nation. I think that's too short a period because you've got less, about 2 years, say, two and a bit, and we're already into 2023. I think there's a risk that it's going to be seen as tokenistic by people on the ground, because what real impact is that going to have for people on the ground within the next 2 to 3 years? There's huge amounts of work to be done if Scotland is going to be leading as a fair work nation by 2025 in terms of practice on the ground. So I think there has to be clarity about, is this about, you know, the fair work as a fair work, we're a fair work nation in terms of the policies we're starting to roll out, or is it the actual practice? When I was reading it, I thought, people will take this as practice should change by 2025. And the reality is, I don't think that's going to be... We've been here 30 years. Sahelia has been here 30 years. Some of us have been here many, many more years. We've not seen change. Things have got worse. So I think there has to be thought given into that time frame and the messaging of that as to what it hopes to achieve by 2025.
That's helpful. Thank you. Is there any other points that we haven't covered that folk are thinking, let's make sure we get this in?
There's just not enough time to cover it.
But
I do think that about the anti-racist employment strategies and poverty and the cost of living crisis and how anti-racist approaches and discrimination against BME people is disproportionately affecting them and pushing them more into poverty and employment issues, etc. But again, I don't think there's enough time to cover that. I was hoping that we will, but I would encourage the committee to hopefully explore that a bit further.
Yeah, obviously part of what we're doing is trying to kind of hear some of the issues, so it's really important that you get it on the record. Fulton's looking to come in.
Yeah, Convener, I think, just like Miriam said there, I don't know whether we're going to have time to go round the witnesses with this specific area, but as I'd asked in the previous panel, and we got a good discussion on, I was going to ask about the bill to incorporate international human rights treaties, in particular the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, but I'm sure as that particular bill moves through Parliament, all of the organisations here and many others, as well as individuals, will be involved in that.
Yeah. Pinar, anything you kind of...
Yeah, just to highlight that, really appreciate the committee listening to our concerns, and I think it's important that we see some form of a statement from the Scottish Government condemning such racist incidents and actions, and to say that I think in Scotland we could do things differently. And I would set an example if we looked at some of the campaigns that's led by the people, especially looking at the concessionary travel, and to see if we could make this workable, and also looking at ways of raising awareness in the communities that the usage of where the hotel is being used. And I think these are the areas that we can definitely, evidently do in Scotland, so that we don't see any form of divisive actions and racism in the communities. And I think these need to be highlighted now. It's really important. And in Erskine on Sunday, what was really sad to see was part of the community in Erskine was divided on both sides. And I'm thinking for long term for the community in there, how is that going to impact them as a community for the long term of the people itself in there discussing about migration? And I think this needs to be considered very seriously, of where we are placing people, the impact it has on that community, the impact it has on the people, and what sort of an image we will be creating in Scotland.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Graham.
Yeah, I mean, this is not an asylum point I'm going to make, but I think it's just to know it, and it's maybe more than that, is that, you know, that a few miles from here, and we've got the Bayou Inquiry, the Shuka Bayou Inquiry happening, and just to mark how potentially important that could be for Scotland in terms of, you know, policing and, you know, what it does to people of colour and black and brown people particularly. And raising the issues around things like use of force and disproportionate use of force, be it taser or be it other forms of use of force, And, you know, as somebody that's got some learned experience, not lived experience in relation to these issues, you know, from London, it made me think about, you know, obviously the McPherson inquiry and but then also some of the other, you know, the other issues around the Scarman report and, you know, and the, you know, the Brixton uprisings, you know, after a long time. And I suppose it's like, I just feel, as, I suppose my point is, I just think Scotland needs to note that context is that it, that inquiry is happening in, and I just think it's incumbent to say it sometimes, because if it's not, and I noticed Jatton rightly mentioned it earlier too, because, you know, it does need to be said that that is happening, and that's a potentially very, very big deal in terms of Scotland's kind of journey in terms of anti-racism.
OK, thanks, Cam. And I think probably the final word, Parveen.
I was just going to say about Scots law and HR treaties, human rights treaties. We talk about the rights of the child, but we talk about things like violence against women, so we're taking it away from the individual. The rights of the child is the individual child, but the woman is women. We really need to think about how do we, and I think it was mentioned in the previous committees, about is it about individual people or is it about a group? And we need to make it about individuals rather than women as a large group.
Okay. And again, we could have gone on all afternoon. So thanks so much. That's going to be really helpful as the committee tries to work out how we're going to take this inquiry forward. But so thank you all so much. That concludes our formal business this morning. So we'll now move into private session. Thank you.